What's up, ladies and gentlemen? It's your boy, Omni-sensei. Welcome to, What If I Was Reborn in Naruto with DRACULE MIHAWK Template. Part 3. Hit that thumbs up. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already done so. Also, remember to check out the original story, link in the description. Without further ado, let's get into it. I didn't expect to meet you here. Itachi looked solemnly at Ryujiro in front of him. Itachi, who is this guy? Kisame noticed the expression on Itachi's face. What kind of person could make Itachi show such a serious expression? It seems that our operation cannot continue as planned, Kisame. Why? Because he's here. Him. Kisame looked at Ryujiro in front of him with great confusion. He's just some random ninja, Itachi. You're being too cautious, Kisame said, casting a glance at Kisame with his eerie Sharingan. He's the ninja I mentioned before. Kisame's eyes suddenly contracted. Oh? He's that genius swordsman? In an instant, Ryujiro's figure disappeared from Kisame's sight, and then a strong sense of fear enveloped Kisame. Ding! Kisame quickly shielded himself with Samahata, looking somewhat horrified at Ryujiro in front of him. So frighteningly fast. I think I understand what you mean now, Itachi. So, this is Samahata? Ryujiro, why are you here? Asuma and Kurenai looked surprised at Ryujiro. Ryujiro glanced at them and said indifferently, My perception is even stronger than that of a sensory ninja. Just now, I sensed the aura of your battle. Strong perception indeed. He's a genius, even stronger in perception. Ryujiro, Itachi is not easy to deal with. We three need to team up to handle him. Asuma quickly bandaged his wounds to stop the bleeding. Fight together, is that a joke? It's not that Ryujiro looks down on Kurenai and Asuma, but if Itachi gets serious, he could defeat Asuma and Kurenai in just a few moves. Asuma-san, Kurenai-san, you take care of Kisame. I'll deal with Itachi alone. Hey, Ryujiro. Are you serious? As he spoke, Ryujiro's figure had already disappeared from their sight. In the blink of an eye, a sharp blade fell upon Itachi. Boom. The shadow clone exploded into smoke. Itachi, such tricks won't work on me. Ryujiro appeared on the water's surface, facing Itachi. You've become stronger. I heard you single-handedly defeated a tailed beast, Jinchuriki. Your strength has improved so quickly over these years. Itachi looked at Ryujiro with some complexity. Ryujiro smirked, Are you here to chat with me? I didn't fully enjoy our battle back then. You must have hidden quite a few tricks. Itachi's gaze shifted slightly, looking at Ryujiro with seriousness. Does Ryujiro know something? It may be regarding his Manjikyu Sharingan abilities, but how could he know about that? He hasn't used it in front of Ryujiro. Let's try it. Manjikyu Sharingan. Swish. In an instant, Ryujiro's vision suddenly blurred. Warning. Warning. Detected mental intrusion. Detected mental intrusion. Intruder is being expelled. Intruder is being expelled. Expulsion successful. In the next moment, Ryujiro's vision returned. Ah! Itachi let out a cry of despair as his Sharingan reverted to its black iris, tears of blood streaming down his cheeks. Tsukuyomi doesn't work on you. Itachi looked at Ryujiro in horror. What happened? Why did Tsukuyomi fail, Itachi's Genjutsu? Is it possible that Genjutsu doesn't work on that guy? Kisame unleashed a terrifying power, sweeping giant waves of water and rocks like bullets towards Asuma and Kurenai. Water style, shark bomb. Whoosh, the calm water suddenly churned into layers of huge waves, forming monstrous water tornadoes and bitingly attacking Asuma and Kurenai. Asuma quickly formed hand seals. Earth style, mud wall. The ground shook violently, and a towering wall rose abruptly in front of Asuma, blocking the raging water. Kisame teleported to Itachi's side. Are you okay? I'm afraid the plan can't continue. Let's retreat for now. As the words fell, the two figures of Kisame and Itachi disappeared. Ryujiro also retracted his chakra sensing. The presence disappeared. It seems he's already gone. Asuma? Kurenai looked at Asuma, who was covered in wounds, with concern. Those two guys were really terrifying. That Kisame is definitely no less than Itachi in terms of being a shinobi. Such water style. 2S rank missing Nin gathering in Konoha, what exactly are they plotting? Seeing their attire, they look like they belong to a certain organization. Thanks, Ryujiro, for arriving in time. Otherwise, Kurenai and I wouldn't be able to deal with those two, Asuma said gratefully to Ryujiro. However, despite this, Ryujiro's expression remained as cold and indifferent as usual. He glanced at the wounds on Asuma's body. Kurenai-san, you'd better take Asuma to the hospital for treatment. Kurenai took Asuma to the hospital. Ryujiro took a quick glance and then used body flicker jutsu to leave. Itachi and Kisame naturally did not leave Konoha, but were hiding elsewhere. After all, what Itachi was most concerned about returning to Konoha was his younger brother, Sasuke. But unexpectedly, such variables had occurred. What exactly happened just now, Itachi? Your genjutsu didn't work on that kid. Kisame frowned and asked. Itachi shook his head wearily. I don't know either. It seems that some mysterious force has expelled the ability of my Sharingan. Expelled? Kisame's brow furrowed even deeper. It seems that this kid also has some secrets. Mysterious power? Konoha is indeed not simple. Let's set the plan aside for now. When I recover, let's go back to the organization first. Kisame nodded without objection and lay down on the bed. That guy. Kisame's eyes narrowed. That guy's power could rival his own. It's unbelievable. Such talent is worth dying under the blade of Samahata. A bloodthirsty smile played on Kisame's lips. Kakashi, Mike Guy, Kurenai, Ryujiro, several people gathered around Asuma lying on the hospital bed. Asuma's face flushed slightly. Although Kurenai also sustained injuries, they were minor compared to having a piece of flesh sliced off the arm and a few ribs broken like his own. Itachi and the rogue ninja from Kirigakure, what was their purpose in Konoha? Kakashi spoke without hesitation. He was the one who understood Itachi's strength the most. Even if Asuma and Kurenai teamed up, they wouldn't be a match for Itachi, let alone Kakashi. Itachi was currently the only one in the Uchiha clan who had activated the Mangekyo Sharingan. Kakashi knew firsthand the terrifying power of those eyes. Ryujiro, why were you immune to Itachi's genjutsu? Not only did Itachi's genjutsu fail earlier, but his eyes also seemed to have been damaged. Kurenai looked at Ryujiro beside her and spoke. Everyone's gaze focused on Ryujiro. It was Itachi Uchiha, after all. When it came to genjutsu, the Uchiha clan was unparalleled. Those sinister eyes contained the power of the Sharingan. Kakashi's gaze was fixed on Ryujiro. The genjutsu of Itachi's Mangekyo Sharingan had no effect on Ryujiro. This was simply unbelievable. Ryujiro shrugged, I don't know either. I just felt a brief loss of consciousness at that time, and I have no idea what happened afterwards. That was Ryujiro's secret, and naturally, he couldn't tell anyone else. To be honest, even Ryujiro himself hadn't expected that the system could help him become immune to genjutsu. He had been a bit careless at that moment, as everything in the Tsukuyomi dimension was under Itachi's control. Fortunately, he had the system as his backup. Who knew? It seemed that Ryujiro had some special physique that made him immune to genjutsu. Although they had never heard of such a physique before, the ninja world was vast and full of wonders, and there were many things they didn't know about. In any case, Konoha needs to strengthen its defenses. The infiltration of two S-rank rogue ninjas into Konoha is not a good sign. Most importantly, we don't know what their objective is. Indeed. Whether they targeted someone specific or wanted to steal something from Konoha. Perhaps only Ryujiro and Kakashi knew the purpose of these two. Although Jiraiya and Kakashi had previously revealed information about Akatsuki, Kakashi was suspicious but not certain. Immune to genjutsu, doesn't that mean genjutsu from this world won't affect me? This was something that made Ryujiro happy. For him, the most limiting factor was undoubtedly genjutsu. If genjutsu didn't work, his strength would not be restricted. There were quite a few ninjas in the ninja world who used genjutsu, and when it came to playing with genjutsu, the Uchiha clan were the masters. If not even the Uchiha's genjutsu worked on him, then what genjutsu could restrict him? Character template, DRACULE MIHAWK, character unlock progress, 94%, 94% completed, only 6% left until the character template was unlocked. It seemed like a small amount, but for Ryujiro now, it wasn't something that could be achieved in a short time. It had been a long time since he had entered the system space. His current strength should be comparable to Mihawk's now, right? After entering the mental space, Ryujiro frowned. It seemed like there was a change in the mental space. Those sparkling dots gave him the feeling of dazzling stars. And at this moment, Mihawk in the mental space was also different from usual. Mihawk turned around, and those sharp eyes stared straight at Ryujiro. This feeling. Ryujiro's eyes widened suddenly. The Mihawk in front of him now was different from before. Before, the Mihawk felt like a puppet, a fighting machine fighting against Ryujiro. But now, the Mihawk gave Ryujiro the feeling that he was facing a living person. You're here again. Mihawk looked at Ryujiro with a calm tone. But Ryujiro's reaction was as if he had seen a ghost, staggering back a few steps in shock. Mihawk spoke. What's going on here? Could it be that there was a change in the system space? In that case, the current Mihawk was not a puppet, but a living person with self-consciousness? Do you have self-consciousness? Ryujiro asked tentatively. Mihawk nodded and said, I should say that my consciousness has always existed. I remember clearly fighting with you, but I couldn't control my body because it was under the control of some force. Although my consciousness was there, I couldn't control my body, but some force was controlling your body. Knowing the truth, Ryujiro couldn't help but take a deep breath. It seemed that the reason Mihawk had been restricted before was because of the influence of the system. When did you regain consciousness? Mihawk shook his head. I don't know either. There seems to be no concept of time in this space. This space seems to have been specially designed for you. Your swordsmanship has improved rapidly over the years. In just a few years, you've reached the level of a master swordsman. It's truly amazing. Mihawk looked at Ryujiro with a hint of satisfaction in his eyes, much like a master looking at his disciple. This made Ryujiro somewhat uneasy. Since Mihawk had developed self-awareness, he was no longer just a puppet focused solely on combat. Moreover, his strength had now increased. The puppet-like Mihawk was like a machine with pre-programmed instructions, executing moves according to the code. Excited, Ryujiro drew his own sword. Let's have a duel. Watching the excited Ryujiro, Mihawk felt a long-lost excitement surging within him as he drew his black sword and smiled at Ryujiro. I was thinking the same. Black Blade, Yoru. The aura belonging to the world's greatest swordsman seemed to envelop Mihawk. Mihawk didn't have flashy or fancy-named sword techniques. After exchanging glances with Ryujiro for a moment, in the next moment, he charged straight towards Ryujiro. Clang! The collision of their blades emitted dazzling sparks, dispersing material energy like lightning throughout the mental space. It stirred up a huge storm, enough to devastate the surrounding area if it were in the real world. Feeling Ryujiro's power, the fighting spirit in Mihawk's eyes grew even stronger. This kind of battle was what he truly desired. Swish! A green sword aura burst forth from the black sword, its unmatched power giving a suffocating feeling. The ferocious green sword aura swept towards Ryujiro. Boom! Similarly, Ryujiro's black sword aura erupted and swept forth. The collision of the two strikes seemed to generate a powerful suction, as if everything around them was about to be devoured. However, this clash was just a test of each other's strength. A sword strike alone was not the standard to judge the strength of a swordsman, especially at the level of a great swordsman. To truly gauge a swordsman's strength, one must engage in close combat. The battle and collisions between the two were accompanied by thunderous energy, causing the entire mental space to tremble. Both Mihawk and Ryujiro could be described as walking disasters. Their terrifying power had surpassed human comprehension. Clang! 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 For a moment, they exchanged blows evenly, seeming like a game of back and forth. The reason Mihawk was always countered by Ryujiro was because they had fought many times before. For Ryujiro, Mihawk's sword techniques were deeply ingrained in his mind. Unless Mihawk had some new moves, their fights would always end in a draw. Their figures continuously darted around. If someone were here, they would barely be able to keep up with their movements with their naked eyes. Using the same moves against you won't work. Although I've never tried this move before, it's indeed a technique I've never used. Are you ready? The aura of the world's strongest swordsman erupted, sweeping through the entire mental space. Just Mihawk's sharp eyes alone sent shivers down one spine. Ryujiro nodded, a hint of solemnity flashing in his eyes. He could feel Mihawk's aura rising. Buzz! Armament haki covered Mihawk's arm, and the armament haki entwined around the black blade underwent a qualitative change, wrapping around the blade like a ribbon. It felt like it could cut through everything. Indeed, worthy of Mihawk. This would determine the winner. Ryujiro assumed a stance, his entire body's strength continuously rising, and chakra gathering on his blade. The armament haki and chakra, two different forces, merged, emitting a sinister and deadly scent. Mihawk's gaze grew even more excited. As expected, Ryujiro had his own finishing move. Black blade. One flash. One sword style. Dark slash. Swish. Their speed was too fast, almost instantaneous. At that moment, the entire world seemed to turn black and white, and even the dimension seemed to shatter from their collision. The immense energy aftermath swept through the entire space. The energy balls containing terrifying power collided, filling the mental space with a black-red thunderous sea that ruthlessly destroyed everything. When the aftermath dissipated, a smile crept onto the corners of Mihawk's mouth. There was a trace of blood at the corner of his mouth too. I've lost. You have surpassed me. The title of the strongest swordsman belongs to you. Gradually, Mihawk's body turned into illusory particles and gradually disappeared, his essence merging into the dazzling light spots. Ryujiro's heart was filled with mixed feelings, but now, completely exhausted, he plopped down onto the ground formed by the mental space. He looked at his sword beside him and glanced at his trembling hands. He had won. He had finally won. From the beginning, Ryujiro wasn't Mihawk's match. Before Mihawk, he was just a scrub being toyed with. When he reached the level of a swordsman, he finally had the strength to fight Mihawk. But even at the level of a swordsman, he was still defeated by Mihawk. In the 2 years since he became a great swordsman, his battles with Mihawk were evenly matched. Perhaps, in some ways, he was still weaker than Mihawk, because at that time, it was like fighting against a machine puppet. Now, he had truly defeated Mihawk. As Ryujiro returned to his senses amidst the joy of victory, his expression suddenly changed drastically. Normally, after a character in the mental space was defeated, they should respawn. But now, Mihawk hadn't reappeared before him. Could it be that Mihawk had truly disappeared? This. Ryujiro widened his eyes, originally exhausted, he jumped up from the ground, staring at his character template in disbelief. Character template, DRACULE MIHAWK, character unlock progress, 100%, this. The progress has actually reached 100%. Am I seeing things? Ryujiro couldn't believe it and rubbed his eyes in disbelief. After several confirmations, Ryujiro finally believed that he wasn't seeing things. 100%. The template progress for Mihawk has finally reached 100%. But he only defeated Mihawk, so how did it suddenly reach 100%? And he didn't feel like his strength had increased much either. Reminder to the host's strength now far exceeds that of Mihawk. This system does not simply mimic the character entirely. When the host completely defeats the imitated character, the progress will reach 100%. The ethereal voice of the system echoed in Ryujiro's mental space. Was it because he defeated Mihawk? Has his strength surpassed Mihawk's? Ryujiro was still a bit puzzled at the moment because he felt that there was still some gap between him and Mihawk, but unconsciously his strength had surpassed Mihawk's? This, come to think of it, Ryujiro didn't feel like an ordinary ninja. In terms of talent in ninjutsu, Ryujiro surpassed others by far, and the key was. He could also use the 8 inner gates. If he uses the 8 gates completely, his strength will increase several times over. Thinking like this, it seems that his strength does indeed surpass Mihawk's. It's not that easy. Having been in this world for so long, he finally had the power to control his own destiny. However, this level of strength is not enough. In the current shinobi world, there weren't many super Kage level ninjas like Ryujiro, but in future there would also be people like Kaguya, Six Paths Madara, and other Otsutsukis. He still has some shortcomings. Has the second template of the system been unlocked? Does the host wish to unlock the second template? Unlock it. In the mental space, particles sparkling like stars spread throughout the space, gradually condensing and merging. A man half a head taller than Ryujiro, with short brown hair and glasses, appeared before Ryujiro. The gentle smile on the man's face made him seem like a gentleman, especially with his eyes adding a touch of elegance. But when Ryujiro saw this person, his face changed instantly. His breathing became rapid, and even his eyes widened. Ryujiro looked at the man in front of him with disbelief. It's actually him. This man. His overall strength definitely surpassed Mihawk's, it even surpassed the realm of the ninja world. His power was terrifying and awe-inspiring. Beneath this fake smile lied an extreme fear once unveiled. Sosuke Aizen. This man from the world of Bleach, with his coldness and ambition, possessed talents that surpass all Shinigami. If it weren't for Kisuke Urahara, Aizen might have truly evolved into the only existence in the history of the Soul Society to break the boundaries between Shinigami, Hollows, and the Soul King. Huh, I didn't expect it to be him. After a brief shock, a hint of excitement appeared in Ryujiro's eyes. Aizen, huh. The system really gave him a big surprise. And Ryujiro has already felt the potential to surpass everything within himself. Hogyoku. Yes, the character template for Aizen came with the Hogyoku. Now Hogyoku has not yet fully awakened. Is it because my Ryatsu has not still awakened yet? Ryujiro murmured in the mental space. Kido, Zanpakuto, and that terrifying spiritual pressure that shakes the world, they were all too powerful in this world. After all, the people in the ninja world were just humans. In the original Bleach series, once a captain-level character released their spiritual pressure, it's not something an ordinary person could withstand. Will spiritual pressure affect ninjas? If so, what kind of terrifying power will be brought by the simultaneous burst of Conqueror's Haki and spiritual pressure? What an unexpected surprise. After exiting the mental space, Ryujiro's demeanor also changed. The sharp edge that was once present in him had diminished considerably. At this moment, he felt more like a scholar. Unlocking a new template didn't mean Ryujiro's original strength that he got from Mihawk had disappeared. His strength still existed, his swordsmanship was still as unmatched as ever, it's just that his demeanor had changed as if he's become a different person. Now, the sword at Ryujiro's waist is gone, replaced by Aizen Zanpakuto. Kyoka Suijetsu. The strongest Zanpakuto in the illusion type, with the ability to completely dominate the five senses. Its power was also called Kanzen Simon. And once under the illusion of Kyoka Suijetsu, even if one knew they were hypnotized, they couldn't escape. In the face of this ability that could completely control the five senses, one could only become a plaything. Life and death of the enemy were at the mercy of the user's thoughts. Ryujiro now felt something was awakening within him, a new and different kind of power. This Ryatsu. This is the immense spiritual pressure that belongs to Aizen. It's simply an immeasurable abyss. Although Ryujiro now had captain-level Ryatsu, he couldn't control it completely. Controlling this immense Ryatsu was not an easy task. Well, time to start training again. Ryujiro jumped off the bed, and at this moment, the voice of the system once again entered his ears. Does the host wish to summon the character DRACULE MIHAWK? Summon characters? Ryujiro's eyelids twitched, and he suddenly felt uneasy. System, what does it mean? Each time the character progress reaches 100%, the character summoning function will be activated, and you can bring characters into the current world. The brought characters are constructed through the energy of the system, equivalent to clones possessing the original character's strength, memories, and consciousness. Damn. That's so cool. Ryujiro's mouth hung open in astonishment, nearly jumping with excitement. Being able to deploy characters meant having an additional companion with superpowers like himself. However, he realized there were also many downsides to having Mihawk. For instance, immunity to genjutsu was not guaranteed. Although they were constructed by system energy, the deployed characters were still real individuals. This meant that while this Mihawk was a clone of the original from the One Piece world, he was still susceptible to genjutsu. The host need not worry about characters being affected by genjutsu. The characters themselves, constructed by system energy, are immune to genjutsu like the host. Ryujiro couldn't help but inhale sharply. Immune to genjutsu. That's too awesome. Do you wish to bring Mihawk, host? Yes. Buzz, the illusory figure of Mihawk appeared once again. His originally dull eyes regained their brightness, and upon regaining consciousness, Mihawk stared at Ryujiro in disbelief. It's you. Indeed. Looking around at the unfamiliar surroundings, Mihawk suddenly realized he had left that strange space. But after a short while, Mihawk's mind also received a large amount of system information. So, I'm not the real Mihawk. A complex expression appeared on Mihawk's face, a hint of bitterness at the corners of his mouth. All the memories he possessed were false, and he was merely a constructed character with fabricated memories. He didn't belong in this world. Ryujiro? Having come to terms with it, Mihawk stood respectfully before Ryujiro. From his wardrobe, Ryujiro took out a set of clothes he had custom-made initially, a kimono similar to those worn by captains in the world of Bleach. After Mihawk changed into it, it had to be admitted that he was quite the heartthrob in this outfit. The mature aura emanating from him was palpable. If any woman laid eyes on Mihawk in this attire, she would likely fall for him instantly. However, the dilemma lay in Mihawk's identity, a problem not easily solved. Should he make Mihawk a shinobi of Konoha? How would that be explained? Telling Tsunade that Mihawk was his friend? Then, if Tsunade wanted to test Mihawk's strength and if Mihawk sliced a mountain in half with one strike? Tsunade would probably be terrified. Moreover, suspicions would arise about whether Ryujiro had colluded with individuals from other villages. After all, Mihawk, a person of unknown identity with formidable strength, would easily raise suspicions. Identity? Identity? Right. Ryujiro's eyes lit up. Who said Mihawk had to stay in Konoha? Since there were organizations like the Akatsuki in the ninja world, why couldn't he create an organization to counter the Akatsuki? Moreover, the ninja world harbored more than just one hidden organization. There was also a more terrifying organization than the Akatsuki. Ryujiro shared his thoughts with Mihawk. He intended to create a force to counter the Akatsuki and subtly play a role as the true puppet master behind the scenes in the ninja world. The organization would be called the Godai 13. Although there was currently only one member in the organization, Mihawk, Ryujiro already had plans for the next member. Orochimaru. Ryujiro believed Orochimaru couldn't have died so easily. Since Orochimaru was able to resurrect in the original story, and there was no progress increase after Ryujiro killed Orochimaru, he was sure Orochimaru was still alive, albeit in some other form. After instructing Mihawk, Ryujiro saw him off, preparing to leave Konoha. As for whether Mihawk would be discovered, Ryujiro wasn't worried. Ordinary ninjas couldn't stop Mihawk. On the way, some members of the Konoha Guard noticed Mihawk, but in the instant their gazes met Mihawk's sharp eyes. Those ninjas were all stunned by Mihawk's gaze. Now, things will get more interesting. A faint smile played on Ryujiro's lips, giving off a chilling vibe. Indeed, Mihawk's departure from Konoha wasn't entirely smooth. Although he appeared to be inconspicuous in his attire, many villagers felt fear seeing the black blade he carried on his back. Furthermore, Mihawk's inherently cold demeanor drew even more attention. During the interception, the ninjas were one by one knocked unconscious by Mihawk. They didn't even have a chance to form hand seals before being incapacitated by Mihawk. This was all according to Ryujiro's instructions. If Mihawk had gone on a rampage during his journey, it would have been difficult for Ryujiro to explain later. Kakashi and Mike Guy arrived later, but Mihawk had already left Konoha. Mihawk was a wanderer by nature, and the task Ryujiro had given him was to recruit powerful ninja into the organization. Given Mihawk's relative freedom in action, the task wasn't too difficult. Moreover, only the strong were attracted to each other. How are they? They're all fine, just knocked out. Just knocked out? Kakashi fell into thought. Not long ago, Kakashi and Guy received a report from the Konoha Guard about a suspicious individual carrying a black blade seen in the village. When they arrived, they were greeted with the scene before them. A figure with a black blade on his back, possessing yellow eyes like those of a hawk. Why did that sound so familiar? Kakashi suddenly thought of someone who also wielded a blade, and had similar but dark green eyes. Could that person be related to Ryujiro? Fortunately, the Konoha guards didn't sustain any injuries. After a checkup, those ninjas who had fainted showed no signs of harm. It seemed the other party harbored no ill intentions, but their identity still raised suspicions. Especially in the current tense atmosphere of Konoha, an unknown figure appearing out of nowhere was unsettling. Right now, Konoha couldn't even confirm whether Itachi and Kisame had left the village. Did anyone see that man coming out of Ryujiro's house? Yes, Lady Tsunade, after that man came out, Ryujiro-san also left. Listening to the Umbu ninja's report, Tsunade furrowed her brows. What is this troublemaker up to, making contact with an unknown individual at such a tense time? carrying a big sword. It seemed he was also a swordsman. The Umbu ninja mentioned that the person's aura resembled Ryujiro's. Could Ryujiro's extraordinary swordsmanship be related to this person? Well, it's better to call Ryujiro and ask. After about 15 minutes, Ryujiro arrived at the Hokage's office. But when Tsunade and Shizune saw Ryujiro, they were momentarily taken aback. Was this Ryujiro? The Ryujiro standing before them now seemed like a completely different person. The square-framed glasses perched on his nose exuded a scholarly aura. The sharpness that used to emanate from him was nowhere to be seen. Now, Ryujiro gave off the impression of a weak scholar, devoid of any strength. A person's appearance could change, but one's aura was developed over time. But the Ryujiro now seemed completely different from before, both in appearance and demeanor. And that smile on his face made Tsunade extremely uncomfortable. While that smile was warm, the stark contrast in Ryujiro's eyes left her feeling uneasy. But Shizune, on the other hand, couldn't resist the charm emanating from Ryujiro now. Her eyes were fixed on him, a faint blush on her face. This Ryujiro seemed to exude a mature charm. Ryujiro, what are you up to now? Tsunade asked in a deep voice. Nothing much, just changing my appearance. It's good to try a new look once in a while, Ryujiro replied casually. Tsunade couldn't shake off the feeling of dread despite his smile. Am I overthinking? Ryujiro now felt familiar to her, like the early days of Orochimaru. Can a person's aura really change so fast? Anyway, let's get back to business. Explain about the man who came out of your house. That man doesn't sound like an ordinary person. What's your relationship with him? Tsunade asked, her gaze intense. That's my master. He's the one who taught me swordsmanship, Ryujiro said, sitting on the couch and taking a sip of the tea on the table, smiling faintly. All my sword skills are from him. Tsunade's eyes widened. Ryujiro's master? Thinking about it, Ryujiro's swordsmanship is indeed different from what they knew. Even the samurai of the Land of Iron can't match Ryujiro's flying slashes. You were taught by that man? Yes. Hokage-sama, if you're worried that my master has ill intentions, those who tried to stop him would have been dead long ago. And, my master's swordsmanship is no less than mine. His slashes can cut through mountains. What? Tsunade slammed the table, losing her composure. Just like Ryujiro's strength, capable of wielding flying slashes comparable to S-rank jutsu. When did such a terrifying figure emerge in the ninja world? Which village is your master from? Tsunade asked sharply. If Ryujiro's master is a ninja from another village or even an enemy of Konoha, then even if Ryujiro hasn't committed any treasonous acts, he would still be suspected of colluding with the enemy. Ryujiro shook his head. My master is not a ninja. He belongs to no faction, he's a wanderer. A wanderer? Such a powerful figure chooses to be a wanderer? Neither Tsunade nor anyone in the five great nations or the ninja world had heard of the name Mihawk. Perhaps, as Ryujiro said, his master is just a wanderer who enjoys traveling and adventuring. All right, I won't get anything out of you. Remember to report to Umbu tomorrow, Tsunade said impatiently, waving her hand. After Ryujiro left the office, Tsunade looked at Shizune and said, Did that brat change his swords? Yes, Lady Tsunade. TSK, this brat, he is really unpredictable. Back at the Hyuga house, everyone looked at the unfamiliar Ryujiro with strange eyes. Is this still the Ryujiro they know? This scholarly demeanor is completely different from the Ryujiro they knew. The aura that Ryujiro used to exude was like a sharp sword, intimidating. But now, whether from his appearance or his demeanor, Ryujiro seemed like a weak scholar. Ryujiro-kun. Hinata looked at Ryujiro before her in a daze. This feeling is so strange. But it's only been one night, why has Ryujiro-kun's entire demeanor changed? However, after a while, Hinata confirmed that the Ryujiro before her was still the Ryujiro she knew. Although his aura had changed, he was undoubtedly the Ryujiro she admired. Ryujiro's change sparked discussions in the Hyuga house. Even Hinata's father, Hayashi, was taken aback when he saw Ryujiro. A person's aura was hard to change. What had Ryujiro experienced overnight? Although Ryujiro's aura had changed, his strength was still recognized by the public. With the new template, Ryujiro needed to retrain and learn the most basic combat methods of a Shinigami. Hakuda, Kido, Zanjutsu, and Hoho. Let's not mention Zanjutsu, Ryujiro's swordsmanship is already unparalleled. What Ryujiro needed to focus on now are Hoho and Kido. Hoho is completely different from Shuunpa. Shuunpa cannot be used frequently, while Hoho allows for continuous use and is faster and more versatile in movement. Ryujiro understood the power of Kido. Compared to ninjutsu, Kido was much stronger, especially Bakudo, which can seal opponents in another dimension without incantation. What Ryujiro needed to do now was to control his spiritual pressure, gather souls to awaken the Hogyoku sleeping within him. Once the Hogyoku was awakened, Ryujiro would evolve to a higher dimension being. Once again, the familiar training ground greeted Ryujiro. Beneath the cliff and the waterfall, Ryujiro sat atop a rock. The falling water seemed to be blocked by an invisible barrier, none of it touched Ryujiro. It appeared as if something diverted the flow of the waterfall, preventing it from reaching him. Thanks to his gradual mastery of spiritual pressure control, the waterfall's flow was influenced by his spiritual pressure and didn't touch him at all. Character template, Sosuke Aizen, character unlock progress, 3%, Hogyoku status, dormant, to activate the Hogyoku, souls must be collected. Currently, Ryujiro hasn't started collecting souls yet. However, he heard that many enemy ninjas had infiltrated the village recently, probing Konoha's defenses. Those guys? They would serve as nourishment for the Hogyoku. Standing up, Ryujiro's figure disappeared from the rock and reappeared on solid ground. He extended his fingers towards a piece of spirit stone, controlling the vast spiritual power within him. Swish! An invisible shockwave shot from Ryujiro's fingertips, punching a hole the size of a coin through the rock. Then, a dazzling lightning bolt completely shattered the rock. Rock, what a scumbag! He climbs on me, trains on me and then destroys me. Simply outrageous. Currently, Ryujiro could proficiently use two Kido spells, Sai and Byakurai. Both spells didn't require chanting and were quite powerful. The power of Byakurai was more terrifying than a typical A-rank ninjutsu. Of course, if Ryujiro could fully control his immense spiritual power, the Byakurai release might rival an S-rank ninjutsu. The power of Kido depended on the spiritual power and strength of the caster. Aizen had easily defeated a fellow Captain Kamimura Sajin, by abandoning chanting and using Hado No. 90, Kurohitsuji. Despite discarding the chant, Kurohitsuji only unleashed a third of its original power, which showcased Aizen's terrifying strength. Even without the Hogyoku, Aizen's strength far surpassed that of the other captains. The only one Aizen feared was Genryusai Shigekuni Yamamoto, the captain commander of the Godai 13. However, in his later stages of evolution, Aizen no longer regarded Yamamoto a very big threat. Ryatsu. It's indeed not easy to control. It's about time to report to the Umbu. That brat is late again. Inside the Hokage's office, Umbu members gathered, waiting for their captain, Ryujiro. Tsunade, the fifth Hokage, was furious. That kid promised to be punctual, yet he hadn't shown up yet. How disrespectful. But even if Ryujiro lacked discipline, Tsunade couldn't do much. After all, he wasn't someone easily controlled. A few minutes later, Ryujiro arrived at the Hokage's office. Tsunade glared at him darkly. Brat, do you even know what time it is? Ryujiro didn't care about Tsunade's anger and smiled faintly. Apologies, Hokage-sama. I was busy with my training and lost track of time. Huh? He actually apologized? Tsunade's anger softened slightly, realizing that being too harsh on Ryujiro, who had arrived, would make her seem petty as a Hokage. Alright, since you're here, you officially assume the position of Umbu captain. The Umbu members, behind their masks, looked at Ryujiro with respect evident in their eyes. Although Ryujiro looked a few years younger than them, they knew he was the hero who single-handedly saved Konoha, slaying the sand village's jonin and repelling a tailed beast. Some admired Ryujiro, yearning for his formidable strength. Among them was one person Ryujiro was very familiar with. Yamato. Ryujiro hadn't expected Yamato to join the Umbu as well. Would Yamato still act as the substitute leader for Team 7 in the future? The changes in the ninja world were beyond Ryujiro's anticipation. Whether it was the plot or the timeline, everything had changed. Since everything had changed, the events he knew wouldn't necessarily unfold according to the original story. Sasuke was still in Konoha, though he hadn't interacted with Itachi yet. Naruto was still training under Jiraiya. After learning each other's codenames, Tsunade informed the Umbu team that their mission was to monitor Danzo Shimura. Although Danzo's route had disbanded, his personality wouldn't allow him to sit idly by. To prevent any unforeseen circumstances, Tsunade needed to know every move Danzo made. Monitor Danzo. Ryujiro pondered as he left the Hokage's office. Danzo wouldn't simply give up. He had an obsessive desire for the Hokage position and power. Though his initial intentions were for Konoha's sake, after numerous changes and encounters with Orochimaru, Danzo's heart had changed. He was willing to do anything to ascend to the position he had dreamt of. Monitoring Danzo was not something ordinary Umbu members could handle. However, Danzo probably wouldn't dare to do anything risky if it were Ryujiro. He didn't have much time to monitor Danzo anyway. His shadow clones could handle the daily missions. He had more important things to do. The borders of the Land of Fire. After Konoha suffered heavy losses in the Chunin exams, the other major countries began to stir. In the eyes of the other countries, the Land of Fire had always been a tempting target. The Land of Fire, with its advantageous geographical location and abundant resources, remained far stronger than the other four great nations despite many wars. This wasn't only due to its geographical location but also because of its powerful ninja population and influence. In the Second and Third Great Ninja War, the four great nations convened a joint meeting and formed a united force to attack the Land of Fire. Now, with the demise of the Third Hokage, these countries had nefarious intentions once again. However, they dared not act rashly after the San and Sound villages jointly invaded Konoha and still lost. Konoha now possessed a swordsman more formidable than the White Fang, who had single-handedly defeated a tailed beast during the Jinchuriki's rampage. Such splendid achievements made the major nations uneasy. At the border, as ninja from enemy nations attempted to infiltrate, the quiet, serene forest was devoid of any sound except for the blossoming blood flowers. Ryujiro, like a quiet shinigami, mercilessly harvested the lives of these ninja. The entire dense forest fell into an eerie silence, as Ryujiro's figure leaped from one position to another, leaving behind afterimages each time he moved. IWA ninjas, Suna ninjas, Kumo ninjas, and ninjas from other countries, all of them lurked along the borders of Konoha, ready to infiltrate during the periods of changing guards. However, in front of Ryujiro, they lost consciousness in an instant upon seeing him, without even knowing what happened. The Kyoka Suijetsu completely dominated the opponent's five senses, making them believe completely in what their master wished regarding a specific object's appearance, form, quality, texture, and even scent. Even if they saw Ryujiro, the Ryujiro they saw before their eyes was nothing but an illusion. The real Ryujiro maneuvered behind them, unnoticed by these ninjas. After absorbing these souls, the Hogyoku finally showed a slight stir, though it was just a faint one. Awakening the Hogyoku was not a simple task, especially since the quality of the souls of these enemy ninjas was not perfect. Each soul was different, and souls of inferior quality couldn't compare to a perfect one, even if absorbed. The silent forest seemed like a forbidden place announcing death. Many ninjas sensed something amiss. When they emerged from their hiding spots and saw the scene before them, they were terrified. One IWA ninja, who had never seen such a bloody scene before, turned pale and began retching against a tree. Two Chunin-level IWA ninjas were also pale, their faces frozen as they stared at the corpses on the ground, their bones chilled. What exactly happened? It's impossible for so many people to be killed without making any noise. This place is too eerie. Could it be that Konoha has already planted Umbu here to watch? Hey! There's something wrong with this place. Let's hurry back to the village. However, when the IWA ninja looked at his companion, his expression turned extremely frightened almost in the next second, as if he had seen the most terrifying thing in the world. Frozen in place, the IWA ninja almost immediately had a look of extreme horror on his face. A trickle of blood appeared at his neck, and his head slowly tilted and slid down, his eyes wide with anger and dissatisfaction towards his fellow ninja. Why? The enemy is right in front of them, why wasn't his comrade attacking? The IWA ninja, whose senses were manipulated, had no idea what was happening. Watching Kuen fall into a pool of blood, he was terrified to the core. When he tried to locate the subordinate ninja, he only saw another body lying in a pool of blood. Aya, what exactly happened? The IWA ninja screamed in despair, wanting to escape the borders of the Land of Fire at all costs. But at this moment, a cold voice sounded behind him. Hado number 4, Byakurai. A dazzling lightning burst from Ryujiro's fingertips. The thunderous roar made the fleeing IWA ninja even more terrified. The white lightning mercilessly swept towards the IWA ninja, giving him no chance to form seals. With a scream, the IWA ninja fell from the sky, his body seeming scorched all over. The IWA ninja's soul entered the Hogyoku within Ryujiro's body. Ninjas from various villages lurking along the borders of the Land of Fire were basically wiped out by Ryujiro. Within Ryujiro's perception, there was no trace of any other ninja. More than 100 souls had been absorbed by the Hogyoku. And at this moment, there was finally a slight stir within the Hogyoku within Ryujiro's body. This feeling. Ryujiro's expression changed immediately, as an immense spiritual pressure erupted uncontrollably from him, instantly causing everyone within the Land of Fire to feel a tremendous pressure. And this pressure made it impossible for anyone to get up. Even Jonins, under the influence of this spiritual pressure, felt as if a huge mountain was pressing down on their backs. Boom! The soaring spiritual pressure turned into a brilliant blue pillar of light, piercing through the sky and stirring up the clouds. The immense pressure made the ninjas unable to comprehend. The surrounding dense forest was instantly submerged under the terrifying spiritual pressure, and the forests along the borders of the Land of Fire seemed to vanish in an instant under the power of spiritual pressure, leaving behind a bald, barren area. When Konoha's ninjas arrived, everyone was shocked by the sight before them. There were corpses of IWA ninjas, Kumo ninjas, Suna ninjas, and ninjas from enemy countries everywhere. Moreover, the dense forest had turned into a flat ground, with even the grass being upturned, leaving behind only bare yellow soil. Hey! Report the situation here to the Hokage-sama immediately. The Jonin's expression was extremely grave. Although they were enemy ninjas, the casualties were too many. Several major nations might take this opportunity to challenge Konoha. The balance of power in the shinobi world had been completely disrupted. At this time, Ryujiro was at home, holding a gem-like spherical object in his hand. The dazzling light emanating from it contained a power beyond human comprehension, and the radiance circulating within the Hogyoku reflected a different future for Ryujiro and others. The true power of the Hogyoku was to manifest what the heart desired according to one's own wishes but required the strength to realize those desires. What Ryujiro desired was a power surpassing everything in this world. A power that surpassed the entire world, a terrifying power even more than that of the Otsutsuki clan. The power he desired was the power to change the rules of the world, to control everything in the world. He understood the importance of power. He needed unmatched strength, fearless in any situation. Although the Hogyoku had awakened now, it had not completely fused with Ryujiro. At this stage, according to the self-consciousness of the Hogyoku, Ryujiro was not enough to be its master. But at the same time, the Hogyoku was also part of Ryujiro's body. As long as Ryujiro's strength reached the point where Hogyoku thought he was qualified to be its master, then Ryujiro would evolve into a higher dimension being. Does the spiritual pressure released just now only belong to me? No. No, that feeling. It's like two forces colliding. One of them seems to be a power unique to me. My own spiritual pressure? Ryujiro knew that character templates weren't just about imitation. He even had the qualifications to surpass the original strength. When the progress of the Aizen template reached 100%, did that mean he could awaken his own Zanpakuto? That power indeed brought Ryujiro a sense of familiarity, a power unique to himself. Looking at the Kyokasuo Jutsu at his waist, Ryujiro couldn't help but fall into contemplation. Perhaps one day, the Kyokasuo Jutsu would disappear, and he would possess a Zanpakuto of his own. What did you say? The bodies of ninjas from other major villages are all over the border of Konoha. Tsunade's expression changed dramatically, her voice so loud that even people outside in the corridor could hear. Ninja from the four major villages infiltrated the border of Konoha, and Tsunade couldn't possibly be unaware of this. The reason they hadn't taken action yet was because Konoha couldn't afford any more trouble at the moment. They needed to recuperate and rebuild their strength. If the four major countries were to launch another joint attack on Konoha and the Land of Fire, Tsunade couldn't be sure if they could withstand such torment anymore. This was troublesome. If the four major countries used this as a pretext to attack the Land of Fire and Konoha again, it would likely lead to the outbreak of the Fourth Great Ninja War. How did those people die? A hint of fear flashed in the eyes of the Chunin, his voice trembling as he spoke, Hokagesima, the enemy ninjas all had their heads severed. What did you say? Tsunade's widened eyes betrayed her fear. Such a cruel method, severing the heads of all enemy ninjas, was horrifying. Who could have done this? Ryujiro? That brat couldn't possibly do this. He was with the members of the Umbu. Could it be him? Tsunade suddenly remembered Ryujiro's master, who had left Konoha not long ago. Could those people have provoked him? But at that time, the sudden immense pressure, that intimidation as if it originated from the soul, even Tsunade herself couldn't help but tremble because of it. The shinobi world was becoming increasingly unstable. A few days later, Ryujiro gradually gained control over the spiritual pressure within him, but he was still somewhat unfamiliar with using Kido. Of course, Shuunpa and Hakuta, he had already mastered them. And now, Ryujiro's strength far surpasses that of a Super Kage level ninja. However, he had not yet reached the level of the Six Paths. The reason for this was because the Zanpakuto could sever souls. The Zanpakuto itself was built from the prototype of the soul. It was only natural that it could sever souls. But Ryujiro had considered something: if the Hogyoku absorbed chakra or Kekkei Genkai along with it, would it give birth to a new power, transferring the Kekkei Genkai and integrating it into Ryujiro's body? The Hogyoku itself was filled with unknown possibilities. With self-awareness, it could judge whether it could absorb something. Ryujiro emerged from the Hyuga house dressed in Umbu attire. After talking to Hinata, his figure suddenly disappeared. That? It didn't seem like the body flicker jutsu. Hayashi thought as he watched Ryujiro leaving. The surveillance on Danzo's team was temporarily suspended today. The reason was that the envoys and ninjas from the Sand Village had arrived in Konoha for negotiations. Inside the village, there was naturally strong opposition. After all, the Sand and the Sound Village had jointly invaded Konoha, causing many villages in Konoha to be destroyed and many people to die. Their children and husbands had all died at the hands of the Sand and the Sound ninjas. They wished to kill these ninjas. However, even if the villagers were opposed, the village leaders still intended to negotiate with the Sand Village. Konoha couldn't afford any more trouble, and the current situation was extremely unstable. If a war were to break out, Tsunade couldn't predict how Konoha would fare. Ryujiro and Tsunade arrived together in the capital of the Land of Fire for the negotiations. The Sand brought three jonin, and leading the negotiations was the advisor of the Sunagakure, Elder Chiyo. Chiyo had long stopped interfering in the affairs of the Sunagakure, but the current situation of the Land of Wind forced her to intervene. She hadn't expected the Land of Wind to face such a situation today, and she had no idea about the invasion of Konoha by Sunagakure. But what shocked her the most was that a Jinchuriki had been defeated by a shinobi from Konoha, and even Baki had died at his hands. So many years had passed since Konoha had produced a genius even more terrifying than the White Fang. Konoha truly was the pool of geniuses. Why were gods so favorably disposed towards Konoha? Was Konoha their own child? Although the Hidden Sand was one of the five great villages, its overall strength couldn't compare to the other four. Long time no see, Elder Chiyo. They actually invited you out? Tsunade looked at Chiyo with some surprise. Chiyo looked at Tsunade and couldn't help but feel that time had passed too quickly. The girl she once knew had become the fifth Hokage of Konoha. At the same time, she was worried about the future of their Land of Wind. The Hidden Sand really had no one available now. Even an old fart like her was being asked to come out and support the facade. I didn't expect that the little girl from back then would become the fifth Hokage of Konoha. Chiyo said softly. Well then, let the negotiations begin. This negotiation was undoubtedly about confirming the losses on both sides. Although the Hidden Sand was in the wrong, they knew that Konoha was currently weakened and wouldn't dare to do anything to them. So, they didn't acknowledge their own mistakes at all, and even wanted Konoha to compensate for their losses. Sand Village still underestimated Tsunade's strength. Perhaps Hiruzen would grit his teeth and agree to the Hidden Sand's conditions for the sake of the greater good. But Tsunade was different. Tsunade, with her fiery temper, wouldn't allow anyone to step on her. Moreover, she was now the fifth Hokage of Konoha. Elder Chiyo, your demands are absurd. After invading Konoha with Orochimaru, you still want Konoha to compensate for the losses? I think you people from the Sunagakure are shameless. Tsunade angrily stared at the group from the Hidden Sand. Fifth Hokage, please mind your words. Huh, my words. If you want me to speak nicely, then you should put away your shameless face. I don't think you really want to negotiate properly. If you don't want to negotiate, then let's go to war. When Tsunade said this, the expression of everyone present in the room changed. Especially Koharu, who immediately turned to Tsunade and yelled. Tsunade! What are you saying? Konoha couldn't afford a war now. It wasn't that Konoha's strength was inferior to the Sand Village, but once the two villages went to war, other villages would inevitably intervene. By then, it was very likely that the Fourth Shinobi World War would erupt, and Konoha had always been the object of desire for other villages. Once other villages joined forces to invade Konoha again, Koharu wasn't sure if Konoha could withstand it like it had in previous wars. Konoha now was not as strong as before, lacking the capital to go through another ninja world war. Tsunade couldn't risk destroying the entire village in a moment of impulse. She couldn't afford to drag the whole of Konoha into war, even if it meant risking her position as the fifth Hokage. Elder Koharu, the Sand Shinobi have already attacked us. Are you still going to help them recover their losses? Tsunade said with a cold smirk. Tsunade, you. Turning red with embarrassment and anger, Koharu glared at Tsunade. She didn't expect Tsunade to completely ignore her position, no matter what, she was still a Hokage advisor. The Sand Shinobi exchanged glances. They dared to be so aggressive because they knew Konoha was currently in decline. They also viewed Tsunade as a newly appointed fifth Hokage. They thought being assertive could suppress Tsunade's arrogance, but Tsunade's sudden slap on the table and cold laughter showed otherwise. If Sand Village wants to negotiate properly, then put away your petty attitudes. Don't think that just because Konoha is currently weakened, you can intimidate us, Tsunade declared. What power does your Sand Village have to negotiate compensation with us, Konoha? If anyone's compensating, it'll be your Sand Village, Tsunade. Koharu angrily stared at Tsunade. But Tsunade paid no attention to Koharu. These higher-ups of Konoha had grown accustomed to peaceful days, thinking that avoiding war was the best course of action. It was because of their weak nature that the Sand Village dared to ally with Orochimaru and attack Konoha. If Konoha had been more assertive, even with 100 times more courage, the Sand Village might not have dared. Now that she had taken on the position of the fifth Hokage, Tsunade was determined to eradicate the village's weak leadership mentality. Compromising was futile, only strong power could deter enemies. Ryujiro couldn't help but look at Tsunade with newfound respect. Tsunade's assertiveness surpassed his expectations. It seemed Tsunade had fully adapted to her role as the fifth Hokage. Konoha needed a more assertive leader to thrive. Tsunade-sama is right. You have no right to negotiate terms, Ryujiro's cold voice echoed in the meeting room. Outrageous. Who do you think you are? Just a mere Umbu ninja. Is this how the Hokage manages her subordinates? The Sand Village delegates stared disapprovingly at Ryujiro, even Koharu's expression darkened. Was this Umbu ninja out of his mind? This was a negotiation between two countries. He, as a mere Umbu ninja, had no right to intervene. Tsunade scanned the faces of the Sand Shinobi with a cold gaze and said. He does have the right to speak. It seems you all have forgotten the pain you suffered, forgotten who defeated you back then. When Ryujiro removed his mask, all the ninjas who had fled from Konoha drew in a sharp breath, fearfully avoiding the face they didn't want to remember. Elder Chiyo. It's him. He's the one from Konoha, the genius swordsman who defeated Gaara. Koharu's eyes widened in shock. Koharu had heard rumors before, but she never expected Ryujiro to be this young. Konoha had produced a monster even more terrifying than Haku. But why? Koharu frowned. Ryujiro didn't exude the sharpness she expected. Instead, he seemed like a refined scholar. But often, such people were the most dangerous. Having the power to defeat tailed beasts and yet disguising oneself as a seemingly weak ninja, this kind of nature was the most frightening. Chiyo's gaze became solemn. Tsunade actually recruited such a person into Umbu. This Hokage was indeed not to be underestimated. Do you really have the right to say such things? But aren't you afraid that your words will affect the relationship between our two villages? Ryujiro sneered. Did you consider the relationship between our two villages when you launched the sneak attack? Chiyo fell silent. Even if Konoha is weakened, your village is still the weakest of the 5 great shinobi villages. Negotiate terms? You're not even worthy. Tsunade looked at Ryujiro with some appreciation. This kid was indeed promising. the faces of the Sand Village delegation turned extremely ugly. Konoha was too assertive. Their assertiveness caught them off guard. This negotiation was supposed to be their home ground, but Konoha's strength made them feel somewhat helpless. Ryujiro, Tsunade. Koharu was still worried about the worsening relations between the Land of Wind and Land of Fire. She was worried that Konoha would not be able to sustain its national strength until the end of the war. But she didn't realize that powerful ninja villages were never judged by their overall national strength. If they had enough high-end combat power to influence the entire war situation, that was enough. Moreover, Ryujiro didn't mind if war broke out, he wanted more souls for Hogyoku. Escort the Hokage advisor down. This negotiation doesn't need the Hokage advisor present, Tsunade said coldly. Koharu looked at Tsunade in disbelief as she was forcibly taken away by Umbu. Chiyo and the San Shinobi broke out in cold sweats. How would they handle this situation now? With both Tsunade and Ryujiro present, the pressure on the Sand Village side was undoubtedly the greatest. Just then, ninjas from the Sand Village entered, whispered something in Chiyo's ear, and then their expressions changed rapidly, glaring coldly at Tsunade. Fifth Hokage? What a clever move. All the ninjas that were sent to spy near the Land of Fire have died. You've angered several ninja villages at once. Aren't you afraid of another ninja world war? If it was a deadlock just now, their situation was now revitalized, and they could even use this as a reason to pressure and intimidate Konoha. Tsunade inwardly thought it wasn't good. The Sand Village ninjas had found out about the situation near the Land of Fire border. Ryujiro looked at the Sand Village and Chiyo with a deep gaze, and in an instant, a terrifying aura swept through the entire meeting room like a landslide and tsunami. Except for Konoha's ninjas, the Sand Village ninjas and Chiyo all felt as if they were carrying a weighty mountain on their shoulders. Ryujiro looked at the Sand Village ninjas impassively. It seems you still haven't understood the situation. You never had the power for equal dialogue in negotiation from the beginning. Chiyo and the Sand Ninja bent over in horror, their souls struck by such terrifying pressure that it felt as if their very essence was being attacked, not just their bodies. Tsunade gazed in awe at Ryujiro's dependable yet domineering figure. This familiar feeling, the mysterious pressure that once pervaded the entire Land of Fire, came from Ryujiro. Just how many secrets does this kid conceal? Even Tsunade couldn't help but be lost in awe at the sight of Ryujiro's dominance. Is Konoha trying to go against the entire ninja world? Chiyo bowed her head in humiliation, feeling an endless fury burning in her chest. She was the elder of Sunagakure after all. How could she bow her head in front of a mere brat? Does your Sand Village really think so highly of itself? Representing the entire ninja world? It's simply a big joke. If I just swing my blade, all of you will die here. As the words fell, a cold glint flashed in Ryujiro's eyes, and his whole being erupted with intense killing intent and a terrifying spiritual pressure like an abyss. Chiyo looked at Ryujiro in horror. Is this kid really planning to leave them here? Ryujiro, don't go too far. Previously, Tsunade's dominance was just a deterrent to the Sand Village. If they really went to war with the Sand Village, it would only benefit the other ninja villages, and Leaf Village wouldn't gain a single advantage, or even might suffer the most severe losses. Tsunade-sama, trust me, as long as I'm here, Leaf Village will always be the number one ninja village. Tsunade's face darkened. This kid. Ryujiro exuded a chilling aura, his elegant scholarly demeanor transforming in an instant as if the present Ryujiro had become a proud king standing at the pinnacle of the ninja world. Feeling the terrifying aura emanating from Ryujiro, Tsunade's fear of him deepened. What kind of monster has been born in Leaf Village? Sand ninjas, it's time for you to make amends. You're just like fish on the chopping block. Chiyo raised her head in anger. Even though she had countless unwillingness in her heart, she was sure that if they said one more word, this kid in front of her would mercilessly swing his blade. Even if they wanted revenge later, they wouldn't have the strength for it. Now, Chiyo was the only Kage-level ninja in the Sand Village. Under Ryujiro's pressure, the Sand Ninjas finally lowered their heads. Each of them was filled with hatred towards Ryujiro. Today's encounter was undoubtedly the most humiliating experience of their lives. That feeling of powerlessness, being pressed down on the head, made each of them wish they could find a hole to hide in. After a brief negotiation, the Sand Village representative angrily looked at Ryujiro and Tsunade. Isn't Konoha's demand too excessive? Konoha actually wanted the Sand Village to compensate for all the losses they caused before, and even hold an apology meeting to apologize to all the villagers in Konoha Village. This negotiation was completely against Sand Village. Tsunade also looked at Ryujiro with some concern. She thought she was already dominant enough, but she didn't expect this kid to be even more dominant than her. You can disagree, but consider the consequences yourselves. The killing intent pervaded the air. Chiyo looked at Ryujiro with a cold gaze. Is this boy really that young? The psychological qualities he displayed were even more cunning than those of veteran Jonin, especially that unknown pressure. Chiyo was sure it definitely stemmed from the soul. He not only has such terrifying swordsmanship but also possesses some soul-influencing bloodline limit? Chiyo gritted her teeth and glanced at the Sand Ninjas behind her, who were full of grief and indignation. Under pressure, they could only endure for a while. Soon, Konoha Village, you will pay the price for your arrogance. This kid, I must personally end him. Chiyo forcefully suppressed the killing intent on her body and, gritting her teeth, reluctantly said, okay, we agree. Tsunade widened her eyes in surprise at Chiyo. Really agreed? Did Ryujiro really bring them that much pressure? Tsunade had never experienced the influence of spiritual pressure on the soul. That kind of pressure was different from the aura and power felt, it was the true fear that stemmed from the soul. A few days later, Konoha Village stirred up a storm. The Sand Village promised to compensate for all the damage they caused to Konoha and hold a public apology meeting for Konoha residents. Kakashi and the other Jonin felt as if they were dreaming when they heard this news. Konoha's strength was not weak, but they were concerned about the increasing instability in the village in recent years and feared that other major villages might take advantage of it. This was the first time they knew that Konoha's high level had actually taken such a strong side. Not only that, but after some time, Tsunade announced shocking news that stunned everyone. That was, Ryujiro was officially appointed as the assistant to the Hokage. Can you tell me now, little one, what was the pressure that covered the entire Konoha that day? Tsunade looked solemnly at Ryujiro. Ryujiro had changed into his usual clothes. In less than a month, he had gone from being the captain of the Umbu to assisting the Hokage. Ryujiro's exposure that day was because the Hidden Sand Village was too arrogant, even wanting compensation from Konoha? It was simply wishful thinking. Not to mention going to war with the Sand Village, even if it were with the other four major villages, it would be what Ryujiro most anticipated. The battlefield was the most suitable place to reap souls. A Kekkei Genkai? I awaken a Kekkei Genkai that can affect souls, Ryujiro said lightly. The only explanation for his ability was a Kekkei Genkai. Many special abilities in the world of Naruto, as well as the special abilities produced by DNA mutations, are referred to as Kekkei Genkais. A Kekkei Genkai that can affect souls? Tsunade suddenly widened her eyes, her breathing becoming rapid. A Kekkei Genkai that can affect souls. No wonder Tsunade felt trembling not out of instinct, but from the pressure her soul couldn't bear. This little monster was truly astonishing. You've killed ninjas from the other four major villages. Aren't you worried that they'll take this opportunity to start the fourth great ninja war? Tsunade looked at Ryujiro again, her gaze deep and serious. Although she appeared unafraid of the onset of war on the surface, it was only superficial. She didn't want war in her heart either. Tsunade, who had participated in the Third Great Ninja War, knew how cruel war could be once it started. The four major villages are not yet at the point of war with Konoha over this trivial matter. In this world, there is a force that is no less than the five great ninja villages, Ryujiro said indifferently. He would be the biggest beneficiary once the war started, absorbing souls to perfect the Hogyoku and elevate himself to an even higher level. What did you say? A force no less than the five great ninja villages? Ryujiro, what do you know exactly? Tsunade looked at Ryujiro with seriousness. Ryujiro glanced at Tsunade and said lightly, you should know about Itachi and Kisame showing up in Konoha, right? Tsunade nodded. They were wearing uniform clothing. Two S-rank wanted rogue ninjas acting together. Perhaps there is an organization behind them that specializes in recruiting rogue ninjas from other villages. If I'm not mistaken, Jiraiya once told you that Orochimaru also joined an organization after leaving the village, and this organization is where Itachi and Kisame belong. After hearing this, Tsunade's face became increasingly solemn. She clasped her hands tightly together. I'll disclose a bit of information. The goal of this organization is the tailed beasts? What? Tsunade stood up completely unsettled, about to continue questioning Ryujiro, only to find that he had disappeared. The Hokage's office suddenly became empty. That organization? Why did Ryujiro know so much about it? Tsunade knew that Ryujiro wasn't someone who would easily follow orders. Even though she appointed Ryujiro as the Hokage's assistant, she couldn't fully control him. Initially, she just wanted to understand Ryujiro better. The curiosity and mystery that Ryujiro brought to Tsunade were unprecedented. But now, Tsunade felt a vague fear towards Ryujiro. Beneath his seemingly indifferent, friendly demeanor, what exactly was he hiding that made Tsunade afraid? Would Ryujiro eventually walk the same path as Orochimaru? Hidden Sand Village. Elder Chiyo. Konoha has crossed its limits. Yes. We're both part of the five great ninja villages, yet Konoha is walking over us. In my opinion, we should unite with the Stone and Cloud Villages and launch a war against Konoha. Konoha's disregard for consequences led to the slaughter of ninja from other villages. Even the Stone and Cloud Villages won't tolerate Konoha's actions. Launching a war. Chiyo was even more disappointed in the Sand Village. Did they truly think they could start a war so casually? The current Sand Village was even less resilient than Konoha to such turmoil. The only high-level combat power that could stand up in the village was herself, an old relic who had already stepped half into the grave. Sand Village was truly declining generation by generation. Although Gaara hadn't been subjected to Naruto's talk no jutsu, his personality seemed to have changed since losing to Ryujiro last time. Of course, Gaara probably only felt fear towards Ryujiro now, a fear that not only Gaara had but also Shikaku. At this moment, inside Gaara, Shikaku was even more depressed as he lay sulking in his cage. That brat from Konoha defeated me without even using chakra? I can't accept it. To think that a grand-tailed beast like himself had been defeated by a little brat. If those guys found out, he'd be the shame of the tailed beasts. That flying slash was truly a terrifying power. Now even this little brat Gaara was afraid of that kid from Konoha. It's ridiculous. Being beaten up by someone changed his personality. His second personality, which had no bias, had been suppressed out of fear. It would be difficult for the non-biased second personality of this grand-tailed beast to come out. Meanwhile, a few days later, Ryujiro found Jiraiya. You want to go to Mount Myoboku? Yeah, I want to learn sage jutsu. Naruto, who was practicing nearby, curiously approached. Pervy sage, what sage jutsu? Is it something really powerful? Ryujiro and Jiraiya exchanged glances. Naruto was about to ask more questions when, whoosh, in an instant, both of them vanished. Huh? The wind was a bit noisy. Naruto stood there, stunned for a long while before he snapped out of it and shouted at the top of his lungs. Pervy sage. Ryujiro. Jiraiya and Ryujiro, in the distance, heard Naruto's roar, their expressions unchanged. But Naruto's voice was indeed like a humanoid loudspeaker. Jiraiya and Ryujiro looked at each other in silence for a long time, but finally, Jiraiya spoke first, asking, why do you want to go to Mount Myoboku? What else can I do by going to Mount Myoboku? Didn't I just say? I want to learn sage jutsu. No one would mind continuing to improve their own strength. I'm not strong enough yet. Jiraiya's expression froze, and the corner of his mouth twitched slightly. Not strong enough? Is this boy sane? You can slice a tailed beast with one stroke, and you still think you're not strong enough? If other ninjas heard you say that, they'd be ashamed. Whether it's Konoha or people from other villages, no one knew the limits of Ryujiro's strength. Learning the sage mode was a sudden idea that Ryujiro had. Natural energy wasn't only found in the three great sacred places, Mount Myoboku Shikatsu Forest, and Ryuji Cave. To get sage mode, one essential requirement was natural energy. However, Ryujiro's purpose wasn't merely to get the so-called sage mode. Instead, it was for experimentation. In the locations rich with natural energy, would the Hogyoku react? He believed that natural energy was an absorbable substance. If that were true, with the terrifying power of the Hogyoku, in the future, when Ryujiro wanted to enter sage mode and bear immense natural energy, it would be unmatched by others. Seeing the serious look in Ryujiro's eyes, Jiraiya sighed, I understand. These past days, he had been guiding Naruto in controlling the Ninetales chakra. It could be said that Naruto had gradually become familiar with controlling the Ninetales chakra in just 1 month. It wasn't a matter of a day or two to travel from Konoha to Myoboku Mountain. It would take at least 10 days to half a month, and if it was a round trip, it would need at least 1 or even 2 months. This didn't even account for the time Ryujiro spent learning sage mode. Before this, Ryujiro had also gone to see Tsunade. Of course, if Tsunade didn't agree, there was nothing she could do to stop him. What surprised Ryujiro was that Tsunade agreed without hesitation. Moreover, when he spoke, it seemed that she had anticipated it. Perhaps Jiraiya had already informed Tsunade about this matter long ago. During the journey, the atmosphere between Ryujiro and Jiraiya was very strange. Several times, Jiraiya wanted to ask Ryujiro some questions but ultimately held back. Absent-mindedly, Jiraiya kept thinking, why did Ryujiro want to learn sage jutsu? Did he really think his strength wasn't strong enough? That casually unleashed flying slash would make any Kage's attack pale in comparison. If one could truly block Ryujiro's flying slash, it would probably only be the fourth Raikage of Kyumogakure. The fourth Raikage, the only ninja among the five great shinobi villages who specialized solely in physical prowess. He had honed his lightning release chakra mode to extreme proficiency and had even severed the left horn of the eight tails in his youth. Apart from the Kekkei Genkai of Anoki, the Tsuchikage of Iwagakure, should also be able to counter Ryujiro's flying slash. But even those two would have to use their full strength just to match one slash from Ryujiro. Just as Jiraiya and Ryujiro were about to head to the next town, suddenly, a blazing flame surged from the side, seemingly wanting to turn everything before it into ashes. Jiraiya's expression changed. In an instant, he disappeared using body flicker jutsu, leaving no trace behind. The surge of flames from the original position instantly engulfed the surrounding vegetation. Kihihi, as expected of one of the Sannin and Konoha's prodigy, dodging my ninjutsu so effortlessly. A shadowy figure emerged from the darkness. A gray headband was wrapped around the figure's hair. His eyes, deep and peculiar unlike those of ordinary people, gave a very eerie feeling. Especially the clothes on the figure made Jiraiya's eyes constrict. You are. Member of the Akatsuki. Jiraiya looked solemnly at the figure in front of him. Oh? You actually know about our organization. That's quite unexpected. The figure, Kakuzu, looked surprised at Jiraiya. And at this moment, several more figures appeared in the woods. Haiden, Deidara, and Itachi Uchiha. Jiraiya's eyes suddenly contracted into pinpoints. These people were all famous rogue ninjas from other villages, and their strength was not inferior to ninja like Kakashi, if not stronger. Damn it. Why were Akatsuki members gathered here? Was this a premeditated plan? Cold sweat trickled down Jiraiya's forehead. Even as one of the Sannin, facing such a situation, Jiraiya couldn't help but feel troubled. Finally, they're all here. I was getting bored waiting for them to show up. Ryujiro flashed a sinister smile, especially when Itachi saw that smile on Ryujiro's face, he was even more astonished. Ryujiro's smile seemed as if he had known they were lurking nearby all along, pretending not to know. In fact, that was indeed the case. Ryujiro even knew that after he and Jiraiya left Konoha, members of the Akatsuki had been keeping an eye on them. Was it Obito pulling the strings behind the scenes? Huh. Ryujiro felt even more disdainful. To be able to mobilize so many of us, it must be you guys. Our leader is quite concerned about you. The prodigy of Konoha. Haydn licked the icy blade, revealing a grim, bloodthirsty smile as he looked at Ryujiro. As if Ryujiro was his prey. Hey, Haydn. This kid's head belongs to me. Huh? Damn it, Kakuzu, say it again. Wanna fight? Bring it on. Who's afraid of who? This situation made the other members of Akatsuki cover their faces. There wasn't a single day where Haydn and Kakuzu didn't fight. In the end, it was Itachi who intervened, and the two stopped. Sannin Jiraiya, Konoha's genius Ryujiro, you will die by our hands today. Boom. The overwhelming killing intent swept towards the two like a tidal wave. The killing intent of these few seemed to solidify into substance, as if there were evil spirits roaring towards Ryujiro and Jiraiya. Crack. Crack. Ryujiro twisted his neck, making a strange noise. Jiraiya stood in front of Ryujiro and said solemnly, Ryujiro, I'll delay them. You go back to Konoha immediately. Leave this to me. Fire style. Great fireball jutsu. In an instant, Jiraiya spewed out a torrent of flames like waves, instantly engulfing the grass and trees in front of him. The terrifying wave of flames seemed to devour everything in its path. Looking at the Akatsuki members swallowed by the flames, Jiraiya's expression remained as serious as ever. He didn't believe that they could be dealt with so easily. Impressive. As expected of you, Jiraiya-sama, you're indeed very powerful. However, that's all there is to it. This is as far as it goes. Itachi's cold voice echoed behind Jiraiya, and suddenly, a kunai stabbed into Jiraiya's waist. With a poof, Jiraiya transformed into a wooden log. Itachi's eyes narrowed. It was a substitution jutsu. When did he? Deidara. We'll deal with that kid. Haydn looked at Ryujiro with a bloodthirsty grin. Got it. Deidara agreed without hesitation. They love destroying geniuses. Art is an explosion. Katsu. Clay spiders scattered across Ryujiro's body like flowers. The clay spiders instantly expanded, and with several thunderous booms, flames and smoke rose skyward, nearly engulfing Haydn in the explosion. Hey, Deidara. Are you trying to kill me? Seeing Haydn's angry face, Deidara laughed sheepishly. Sorry, sorry. I got too excited. But on the other side, Itachi showed an expression changed as if he had seen a ghost. He shouted towards Deidara and Haydn in fear. You too. What are you doing? Huh? Haydn and Deidara froze simultaneously. As the sea of fire dispersed, their expressions shifted dramatically to match Itachi's horrified look. Kakuzu? What on earth is going on here? Why is Kakuzu there? They clearly saw that kid from Konoha was there just a moment ago. Hey, Kakuzu. Are you alright? Haydn and Deidara walked over with concern. However, Kakuzu felt something off in their gaze, as his deep green eyes erupted with a terrifying intent. Is Kakuzu serious? Sensing this chilling intent, even Haydn and Deidara couldn't help but shiver. The legendary Sannin and genius of Konoha? It seems you two are worth hunting down. Haydn and Deidara halted, looking at Kakuzu in shock. What are you talking about? Water style, water wall. Lightning style, false darkness. From the mouths of Earth Grudge Fear's masks, sharp lightning spears and powerful water bubbles attacked Deidara and Haydn. With Kakuzu's forbidden jutsu, he didn't need hand signs to unleash ninjutsu. Their sudden attack caught Haydn and Deidara off guard. With a thunderous crash, countless lightning serpents danced within the waves, leaving devastation in their wake. Deidara and Haydn quickly jumped onto a nearby tree. Witnessing this scene in horror, countless trees collapsed from the impact, leaving the forest bare. Hey, hey, hey! Kakuzu doesn't seem like he's joking. Did Kakuzu just mistake us for Jiraiya and that guy, Ryujiro? What's going on? Itachi's face was incredibly solemn. Itachi, who had never felt fear before, felt a hint of it now. When was the genjutsu cast? With his Mangekyo Sharingan, capable of using the Tsukuyomi, he couldn't find a way to break the genjutsu. The question was, who cast this terrifying genjutsu? Jiraiya? Impossible, Jiraiya wasn't skilled enough to cast genjutsu at this level, which even his Mangekyo Sharingan couldn't break. Ryujiro? While Ryujiro was extraordinary, his displayed strength was based on swordsmanship, but genjutsu. The situation was beyond his control. Jiraiya and Ryujiro? Itachi glanced around and saw Jiraiya and Ryujiro looking at them from another direction. Why did he feel something eerie upon seeing them? What was the problem? Before Itachi could contemplate further, sharp black tentacles, composed of numerous strands, swept towards his position. This scene horrified Deidara and Haydn even more. Was Kakuzu out of his mind? That's Itachi. Meanwhile, elsewhere, observing the chaos among the Akatsuki members, Ryujiro smirked. With the ability of Kyokasuijetsu, he could manipulate their senses entirely. The moment he drew his sword, the members of Akatsuki fell under his hypnosis. In Ryujiro's eyes, Akatsuki members appeared to be fighting each other. However, in Jiraiya's eyes, the Akatsuki members seemed to have fallen into a state of slumber. Ryujiro, when did you use genjutsu? How long can this genjutsu last? How long? Ryujiro smiled knowingly. Only when Ryujiro wanted to release the ability would the Akatsuki members return to normal. Otherwise, unless they encountered Zanpakuto itself, they would be forever trapped in the ability of Kyokasuijetsu. Everyone has some hidden tricks. This genjutsu won't last long. Let's get out of here. Ryujiro lied. He couldn't possibly reveal the extent of his ability to Jiraiya, and Jiraiya was also currently under hypnosis as well. Otherwise, the scene in his eyes wouldn't be the sleeping Akatsuki members. Glancing at the sleeping Akatsuki members, Jiraiya nodded. Ryujiro and Jiraiya's figures disappeared into the forest. As Ryujiro and Jiraiya moved further away, the Akatsuki members who were fiercely battling suddenly stopped, each looking at the other in astonishment. Kakuzu, Deidara, Itachi, what on earth is going on? Weren't they just fighting against Ryujiro and Jiraiya? How come the people before them now are their familiar faces? Looking around at the devastation and signs of battle, it was clear that a major fight had occurred between them. Especially Itachi, with his solemn expression, had activated his Mangekyo Sharingan and was about to use Amaterasu to end this battle. Genjutsu. We're all trapped in a genjutsu, mistaking each other as enemies. From start to finish, the people we've been fighting against weren't Jiraiya and Ryujiro. The ones we've been fighting against this whole time were our own members. Itachi's voice trembled slightly. Even with the Mangekyo Sharingan, he fell into the genjutsu, and what's even more peculiar was that everything before him felt incredibly real. He didn't even know when they were put under hypnosis. Hey, Itachi, you have those eyes, yet even you? Kakuzu asked in disbelief. Itachi nodded bitterly. For a member of the Uchiha clan with the Mangekyo Sharingan to fall under genjutsu, if word got out, no one would believe it, but that was the reality. Huh. Kakuzu, Hayden, and Deidara couldn't help but gasp, even Itachi, with the Mangekyo Sharingan, was hypnotized. There was no intelligence indicating that Jiraiya and Ryujiro had that high level of genjutsu abilities. When did this happen? Scanning the surroundings, the shadows of Jiraiya and Ryujiro had completely disappeared. Damn it. They were completely outplayed. As everyone clenched their fists, that feeling of being toyed with but unable to do anything, it was an utter disgrace for them. With things at this point, they couldn't afford to pursue Jiraiya and Ryujiro anymore. Itachi suggested returning to the organization first. Kakuzu and the others had no objections. In the next moment, their figures disappeared from the devastated area. Jiraiya couldn't understand why the young man in front of him possessed so many mysterious and unpredictable jutsus. The genjutsu displayed by Ryujiro was something he had never seen before, and he didn't even see the hand seals Ryujiro used during the genjutsu. Despite both of them being from the same village, there was something unsettling about Ryujiro that Jiraiya couldn't shake. Jiraiya sighed silently in his heart. It seemed like a genius like Ryujiro, residing in Konoha, was akin to a double-edged sword. If someone understood Ryujiro better, perhaps the current situation wouldn't be as it was. Recalling everything that had just happened, Jiraiya couldn't help but feel a bit anxious. It appeared that the Akatsuki had set their sights on Ryujiro. Jiraiya had some knowledge of the Akatsuki. After all, Orochimaru had joined the organization after defecting. During his investigation, Jiraiya had also discovered that the organization was far from simple. Especially after encountering members of the Akatsuki, who were all S-ranked missing nin from various major shinobi villages, it seemed like there might be some hidden conspiracy threatening the shinobi world. What a headache! First, the instability in the shinobi world, and now the emergence of a powerful organization of unknown origin. And then there was this kid. Jiraiya glanced at Ryujiro beside him. Tsunade mentioned that this kid had awakened a Kekkei Genkai that could affect souls, but why did Jiraiya feel like it wasn't as simple as that? Just being able to affect the soul Kekkei Genkai. What about that mysterious black substance? Was it some unregistered jutsu developed by Ryujiro? Ryujiro harbored too many secrets. The journey from Konoha to Mount Myoboku was still far. If they wanted to reach Mount Myoboku quickly, they would have to use the reverse summoning jutsu. If they used the reverse summoning jutsu, as Ryujiro wasn't contracted with the toads, only Jiraiya alone could reach Mount Myoboku. Kid, I have a way to quickly reach Mount Myoboku, but it requires you to make contract with the toads of Mount Myoboku, Jiraiya said slowly, stopping in his tracks. Quickly reach Mount Myoboku, with the reverse summoning jutsu? Ryujiro was aware of the reverse summoning jutsu, but he wasn't particularly keen on contracting with the toads, to be honest. He felt a bit uncomfortable with a creature like a toad. Well, the journey to Mount Myoboku from here would still take more than 10 days. It was just a matter of making a contract with the toads of Mount Myoboku. After all, he didn't need the summoning jutsu himself. Ryujiro nodded. Jiraiya's reason for wanting to use the reverse summoning jutsu at this time was because the Akatsuki had already set their sights on them. There were many unstable factors along the way, so it was better to use the reverse summoning jutsu to travel to Mount Myoboku. With a bang, a plume of smoke rose, and a large scroll appeared in Jiraiya's hand. This is the summoning contract of Mount Myoboku. Once you sign the contract, you'll be able to summon the toads of Mount Myoboku, Jiraiya explained. Of course, the reverse summoning jutsu only works for the contracted individual. Ryujiro glanced at the names on the contract. Several names caught Ryujiro's attention, Minato Namikaze, the fourth Hokage. Ryujiro then wrote his name on the contract. Jiraiya clasped his hands together. Since Jiraiya himself didn't know the reverse summoning jutsu, he needed to summon the toad sage of Mount Myoboku. In fact, Jiraiya couldn't activate sage mode on his own. He needed the power of the two sage toads of Mount Myoboku to enter sage mode. With a pop, two toads, one green and one purple, appeared on Jiraiya's shoulders. Fukasaku and Shima had already gathered natural energy in Mount Myoboku upon sensing Jiraiya's call. And now, Jiraiya had already entered sage mode. Initially, the two sage toads thought Jiraiya was in some danger, but upon seeing that there was no battle occurring in the vicinity, they relaxed slightly. "Jiraiya, what did you summon us for?" Shima asked, looking displeased. Even though she found the young Jiraiya adorable, interrupting her cooking for her husband was unforgivable, even if it was Jiraiya. Especially since it seemed like there was no urgent matter. Jiraiya scratched his head awkwardly and smiled, "I need to trouble you two with something." Only when they heard that Jiraiya had something to discuss did the expressions of Fukasaku and Shima improve slightly. "Go on. I want you two to summon me and him to Mount Myoboku," Jiraiya said, gesturing towards Ryujiro. Both Fukasaku and Shima glanced at Ryujiro in confusion. "Is he the new name added to the summoning contract just now?" Fukasaku asked. Jiraiya nodded. Fukasaku leaned in close to Jiraiya and whispered, "Young Jiraiya, you should know the rules of Mount Myoboku. Even if he signed the contract, he can't be taken to Mount Myoboku at will." How could Jiraiya not know this? That was precisely why he summoned the two sage toads. Seeing Jiraiya walk away, Ryujiro didn't pay much attention. He leaned against a tree, waiting leisurely. Upon learning about Ryujiro from Jiraiya, the expressions of Fukasaku and Shima became serious. Although he was a shinobi of Konoha, the words spoken by Jiraiya gave them a strange feeling about Ryujiro. Even though they were worried, there was no malice emanating from Ryujiro, and besides, young Jiraiya wouldn't have misjudged a person. "Well then, young Jiraiya, this time I'll grant your request, but it won't set a precedent," Fukasaku said solemnly. Jiraiya nodded. "Boy, your name is Ryujiro, right?" Fukasaku said with a smile. Ryujiro nodded. Once everything was prepared, Fukasaku took out a scroll. Reverse summoning jutsu. With a pop, they all turned into smoke and disappeared. The next moment, Jiraiya and Ryujiro arrived at Mount Myoboku. Instantly, Ryujiro felt the difference between Mount Myoboku and the outside world. The abundant natural energy of Mount Myoboku startled Ryujiro, and his previously drowsy mind instantly sharpened. "Ryujiro, welcome to Mount Myoboku." Ryujiro furrowed his brows slightly at the peculiar plants of Mount Myoboku and the numerous toad statues scattered around. It seemed he needed some time to get used to a place so full of toads everywhere. "Before you practice sage mode, Jiraiya, take Ryujiro to meet the great toad sage," Fukasaku instructed. Jiraiya was somewhat surprised. Did the great toad sage already know they had arrived in Mount Myoboku? Truly worthy of being a toad sage who had lived for thousands of years. Jiraiya glanced at Ryujiro. Ryujiro nodded silently, indicating he had no objections. Guided by Fukasaku and Shima, Ryujiro followed them to meet a large orange toad wearing a necklace with a Buddhist bead. The oldest toad of Mount Myoboku, Gamamaru, who has survived for over 1,000 years since the era of Kaguya, was revered as the great toad sage and possesses extremely accurate prophetic abilities. Together with the white snake sage of Ryuchi Cave and the slug sage of Shikatsu Forest, they oversee the three major places of the shinobi world. In fact, in his dreams, the great toad sage had already dreamt that Jiraiya would bring a young boy. But when the great toad sage saw the boy, his cloudy, aged eyes couldn't help but tremble slightly. "Can't see through." After looking at him for a while, the great toad sage sighed softly and said to Fukasaku, who was sitting deep, "Fukasaku, guide the young one in practicing senjutsu. Jiraiya, stay." Fukasaku was a little surprised, but since it was the great toad sage's command, he wouldn't inquire further. However, he was curious why the great toad sage didn't say anything more to Ryujiro after just looking at him. He originally thought the great toad sage would say something to him. Under Fukasaku's guidance, Ryujiro passed through a strange terrain. The scenery of the three most sacred places of this world was quite different from the outside world, or it seemed that these three sacred places were not in the same world as the shinobi world. "Before practicing senjutsu, do you want to eat something?" Fukasaku kindly offered. Ryujiro shook his head. "Thank you, Fukasaku-sama, but I have food in my bag." Ryujiro was prepared before coming to Mount Myoboku. The food on Mount Myoboku is all bugs. Ryujiro couldn't accept eating bugs. He would never eat such unpalatable food in his lifetime. Oh, alright then. I wanted you to taste my wife's cooking, Fukasaku said somewhat regretfully. After hearing Fukasaku's words, even Ryujiro's mouth couldn't help twitching. He would rather let Fukasaku enjoy that delicious meal himself. After passing through a strange path, Ryujiro saw many toad statues in front of him, like a strange waterfall formed by the convergence of turbid oil. Fukasaku brought Ryujiro to this place and explained in detail how to practice senjutsu. To practice senjutsu, one must first feel the natural energy. Since Ryujiro had never felt natural energy before, he naturally couldn't grasp the feeling of absorbing natural energy. Fukasaku smeared a drop of toad oil on Ryujiro's arm. Toad oil can absorb natural energy on its own. However, if one cannot control the balance well, they will suffer from the invasion of natural energy and turn into a stone statue. To control natural energy well, one must maintain a balance between natural energy, spiritual energy, and physical energy, so as to grasp the mystery of mastering senjutsu chakra. At this moment, Ryujiro's right hand had undergone some changes. This feeling. Is it natural energy? In an instant, Ryujiro grasped the feeling of natural energy entering his body. At this moment, he felt the surging natural energy spreading throughout Mount Myoboku. So this is natural energy. As long as the three energies are balanced, everything would be fine, and Ryujiro controlled the three energies in his body to maintain balance. Suddenly, Fukasaku, who was beside him, felt the change in Ryujiro's breath and looked at Ryujiro in shock. This guy has just encountered natural energy for the first time, yet he has mastered the method of controlling balance so quickly. Back then, just controlling the balance of the three energies took Jiraiya more than a month to accomplish in order to practice sage mode. This kid's talent is even more terrifying than what Jiraiya said. Even Minato, when he came to Mount Myoboku, took half a month to control the balance of the three energies. Wait! Fukasaku's eyes contracted into needle-like shapes. Not only did Ryujiro master the balance of the three energies, but he even began to gradually master senjutsu chakra. Looking at the faint orange eyeshadow at the corner of Ryujiro's eyes, Fukasaku couldn't help but inhale sharply. It hasn't even been a cup of tea's time since the beginning, and Ryujiro had only mastered the balance of three energies. If Ryujiro hadn't never sensed natural energy before, Fukasaku would have doubted whether this was truly Ryujiro's first time practicing sage mode. Meanwhile, Jiraiya, who had just left the Great Toad Sage, was heading towards Ryujiro's training spot. He was still pondering the Great Toad Sage's words. I can't see through him, I can't see his future. Even the Great Toad Sage couldn't see through Ryujiro. It was really intriguing. Already started? Jiraiya noticed Ryujiro meditating in the clearing. He just glanced at him. But when he looked closely, he suddenly stopped in his tracks, staring at Ryujiro in shock. Ryujiro's aura had changed from before. The ethereal, otherworldly aura was like that of a seated sage. The natural energy of all Mount Myoboku seemed to be rushing into Ryujiro's body. Fukasaku? He's already entered sage mode, hasn't he? Jiraiya already knew the answer but was unwilling to believe that Ryujiro had mastered sage mode in such a short time. Fukasaku sighed. Jiraiya boy, you're right. This kid has already entered sage mode and is gradually mastering sage chakra. Gasp. Jiraiya was shocked to his core. He could only persuade himself thinking that Ryujiro was a genius. Perhaps this was the talent of a genius. But entering sage mode? What the heck is that? Back then, it took him so much effort to practice sage mode. This kid is not a genius, he's a monster. At the next moment, Ryujiro's body suddenly trembled, and the faint orange eyes at the corners of his eyes slowly faded away. When Fukasaku thought Ryujiro was about to exit the sage mode, suddenly, a strong and terrifying wave of senjutsu chakra burst out from Ryujiro's body. The terrifying storm made all the natural energy of Mount Myoboku become restless, and the pool of toad oil stirred up layer by layer of waves. What shocked Fukasaku was not the chakra energy erupting from Ryujiro's body but the fact that he felt the abundant natural energy of Mount Myoboku madly pouring into Ryujiro's body. An immense amount of natural energy flooded into Ryujiro's body. Fukasaku, something seems off about Ryujiro's condition. Such a massive amount of natural energy entering his body will cause an imbalance. Jiraiya shouted in horror. Once the natural energy completely invaded Ryujiro's body, he would turn into a stone statue. However, at this moment, Jiraiya and Fukasaku couldn't do anything. If they were to disturb Ryujiro rashly, the consequences might be even more unpredictable. The eyes of the toad sage narrowed. Jiraiya boy, carefully observe the aura on Ryujiro's body. Jiraiya, in a panic, was first stunned, then carefully observed Ryujiro. The next moment, his expression changed drastically, and his breathing became rapid. Sage mode, Ryujiro's sage mode hasn't been released. What on earth is happening? Fukasaku looked at Ryujiro in shock. Even he didn't know what was going on in this situation. I don't know either. Jiraiya stiffened in place. Even Fukasaku didn't know what was happening. What exactly was this kid Ryujiro doing? He could feel the entire Mount Myoboku's natural energy crazily converging towards Ryujiro's position. It was as if Ryujiro was an invisible vortex, drawing all the natural energy into his body. Wasn't he afraid of any accidents? His courage was too great. Normally, entering Sage Mode would have some characteristics, such as the orange eyeshadow appearing at the corners of the eyes for Mount Myaboku's inherited Sage Mode. However, immediately after Ryujiro's features disappeared, there was no such thing on Ryujiro. And Ryujiro hadn't released his Sage Mode. The overflowing Senjutsu Chakra, even just a bit, made Jiraiya extremely fearful. That strong chakra was completely different from when he entered Sage Mode. It was as if the entire Mount Myaboku's natural energy was being drained. Even Shima, who was cooking at home, noticed something unusual. When she arrived at the place where Sage Jutsus were practiced, she looked at Ryujiro and also showed a shocked expression. The vast natural energy poured into his body, yet there were no signs of petrification. They didn't know that it wasn't Ryujiro absorbing the natural energy. Although there was natural energy and abundant Sage Chakra in Ryujiro's body, it was not Ryujiro who was engulfing the natural energy, but rather the Hogyoku, which ruthlessly absorbed every time the natural energy was converted into Sage Chakra. Moreover, Ryujiro's body was not an ordinary body. Even though Hogyoku had not recognized anyone as its owner yet, it had already merged into Ryujiro's body. Moreover, Hogyoku was now activated. The huge amount of natural energy continued to pour into Ryujiro's body. Fukasaku, Shima, and Jiraiya used their hands to protect themselves from the Sage Chakra storm erupting from Ryujiro's body. Jiraiya boy, could Ryujiro be the child of prophecy mentioned by the Great Toad Sage? Fukasaku asked suspiciously. With such talent and the unprecedented situation before them, Fukasaku somewhat suspected that Ryujiro was the child of prophecy mentioned by the Great Toad Sage, who would save the ninja world in the future. Jiraiya shook his head. When the Great Toad Sage talked to him just now, he had already confirmed to the Great Toad Sage that Ryujiro was not the so-called child of prophecy. On the contrary, Ryujiro's destiny was elusive and mysterious. Even the Great Toad Sage did not know what path Ryujiro would take in the future. Boom! A terrifying Sage Chakra storm erupted again, and cracks of varying sizes appeared on the surface of the toadstones surrounding them. Such pressure from Sage Chakra, even Fukasaku and Fukasaku, had never felt before. When the dust settled, Ryujiro emitted a unique aura. This feeling was as if it belonged to a different level of life. Although Ryujiro didn't seem to have changed much, Fukasaku and Shima were already gaping. The Ryujiro in front of them was undoubtedly still in Sage Mode. What on earth was going on? Ryujiro clenched his fist, feeling the immense power brought by Sage Chakra inside his body. Is this Sage Chakra? His state indeed seemed to be in Sage Mode, but this Sage Mode didn't bring Ryujiro many of the typical features of Sage Mode. A perfect Sage Mode? A high concentration Sage Chakra gathered at Ryujiro's fingertips, forming a curved blade made of chakra. Jiraiya widened his eyes suddenly. Could Sage Chakra be manipulated like this? Moreover, with such a dense Sage Chakra, if it were to erupt, Jiraiya didn't dare to imagine its terrifying power. Slash. Ryujiro cut open a gash on his arm. What are you doing, Ryujiro? Shima exclaimed, but then her eyes widened suddenly. The wound on Ryujiro's arm was gradually healing at a speed visible to the naked eye, and in no time, the wound on Ryujiro's hand disappeared. There wasn't even a trace of the scratch. Such recovery power. Jiraiya opened his mouth wide. It was like the recovery ability possessed by the first Hokage. Fukasaku and Shima looked at the healed wound on Ryujiro's arm in shock. Sage body? Did Sage Chakra transform Ryujiro's body into a Sage body? This was absolutely impossible. This was not a transformation of Sage body caused by Sage Chakra, but an evolution brought to Ryujiro's body by Hogyoku. It was an evolution of Ryujiro's body to another level of life by Hogyoku. A smile appeared at the corner of Ryujiro's mouth. He could already feel the power of Hogyoku. It seemed that Hogyoku was gradually acknowledging him as its master. Ryujiro, do you feel any discomfort? Fukasaku and Shima were somewhat worried after Ryujiro's body was infused with so much natural energy just now. Ryujiro shook his head. There's nothing unusual. But it seems that I am already in Sage Mode now. And this Sage Mode didn't have a time limit, which meant it was eternal. Fukasaku and Shima glanced at each other, showing a bitter smile on their lips. They were truly witnessing the birth of a monster. Perfect Sage Mode. Although Ryujiro appeared no different from before, the terrifying aura emanating from him made both Fukasaku and Shima break out in a cold sweat. Jiraiya was completely dumbfounded. Sage Mode. Ryujiro in this state was already in Sage Mode? The Sage Mode of Mount Myaboku should have distinct characteristics, even the eye shadow at the corners of the eyes was absent. Could it be that Ryujiro had even erased the characteristics of Sage Mode? Ryujiro felt the changes happening within his body, with chakra circulating through every vein endlessly, filling every part of him. If he were to open the 8 gates in this state, the power would be terrifying. I didn't expect Ryujiro would master Sage Mode so quickly. Have you ever seen Sage Mode in this state, Sensei? Fukasaku shook his head. Sage Mode in this state, even with the innate talent like Minato's, it's impossible to be like Ryujiro. And although the natural energy around wasn't pouring into Ryujiro's body as crazily as before, his body was still absorbing natural energy like a toad oil. That meant even if Ryujiro wanted to maintain this state for a long time, it was possible. Fukasaku couldn't help but take a deep breath. Can this be called Eternal Sage Mode? Ryujiro, he's too terrifying. When Ryujiro appeared in front of the Great Toad Sage again, even the thousand-year-old Great Toad Sage was moved. Being in Sage Mode as a norm, and even automatically absorbing natural energy. Even when Hagoromo practiced Senjutsu, he wasn't as terrifying as Ryujiro. The future was so uncertain, this kid's future was quite bewildering. For the shinobi world, it's hard to say whether it's good or bad. The fact that such a person wasn't the child of prophecy was indeed worrying. After meeting the Great Toad Sage, Fukasaku and Shima warmly invited Jiraiya and Ryujiro to their place for dinner. Jiraiya immediately shivered at the thought of those hard-to-swallow bugs and quickly declined. Even if he could eat them, he didn't want to experience that taste again. The disappointed Fukasaku and Shima, after being rejected, wore regretful expressions. Next time, when Jiraiya and little Ryujiro are free, they will make them taste the delicacies of Mount Myoboku. In the Hidden Rain Village, various peculiar buildings stood tall. And surprisingly, all members of the Akatsuki were recalled. Even with your combined power, you all have failed. It seems that this Ryujiro is truly formidable. The person with a serious and cold expression spoke in a deep voice. Especially with those purple eyes with concentric ripples, they gave off tremendous intimidation. Rinnegan. After impersonating as Uchiha Madara and finding Nagato, Obito informed Nagato about Ryujiro's information in Konoha. Obito believed Ryujiro was a potential threat, so he manipulated Nagato to mobilize the Akatsuki members to assassinate Ryujiro. But the outcome was unexpected for Nagato. Even if the mission failed, Nagato thought at least it could severely injure Ryujiro, but here the members of the Akatsuki themselves were injured? They mistook their own comrades for Ryujiro and Jiraiya and fought each other. Nagato, who controlled pain, looked at Itachi. It is said that the Sharingan of the Uchiha clan can see through any genjutsu, right? Even Itachi's eyes didn't notice when he was under genjutsu. But the key reason was that Obito didn't tell him about Ryujiro's ability to use genjutsu. Nagato was a disciple of Jiraiya, so he naturally knew his teacher couldn't use genjutsu of such a high level. Even with his Mangekyo Sharingan, Itachi couldn't break free from it. This Ryujiro was indeed troublesome. Now that the Akatsuki has attracted the attention of the major shinobi villages, their actions must speed up. The plan to capture all the tailed beasts. A dark light flashed in Pain's eyes. Even if the people of the Hidden Sand Village were dissatisfied with Konoha, it was useless now. Go to war with Konoha? They didn't have that strength. They only had a single Kage-level ninja, Chiyo. Starting a war with Konoha is just giving other major villages an opportunity. It's even possible for other major villages to launch a surprise attack on the Hidden Sand Village during this empty period, and by then, everything would be irreparable. After Chiyo strongly suppressed the dissatisfaction among the higher-ups, the Hidden Sand Village also returned to its former peace. The position of the Kazekage couldn't be vacant for long, but now, even if the Hidden Sand Village wanted to elect a new Kazekage, there's no good candidate. Someone approached Chiyo and asked her to take up the position of the fifth Kazekage, but Chiyo flatly refused. Originally, Chiyo's plan to live in seclusion meant not getting involved in the affairs of the Land of Wind and the village. Now, she had no choice but to come out. Besides, even if she became Kazekage at her age, she wouldn't have many good years left to live, and there are many things to deal with as the leader of a village. And for a while, because the position of Kazekage was temporarily vacant, the people of the Hidden Sand Village didn't have a candidate to recommend. After a long time, Chiyo finally summoned the higher-ups and elected Gaara as the fifth Kazekage, of course not immediately to the position of Kazekage as Gaara was now only 12 years old. He needed at least another 2 or 3 years before he could take up the position of Kazekage. And during this time, they should help grow Gaara as the future Kazekage. The current Gaara no longer has the paranoid personality he used to have, and as a Jinchuriki, Gaara was also qualified to become the Kazekage. At first, the higher-ups in the village disagreed, but eventually, due to the lack of candidates who could take up the position of Kazekage, they reluctantly accepted the proposal. Gaara looked out over the entire Hidden Sand Village on the yellow soil, his eyes shining with a strange light. Shikaku, the village intends to elect me as the next Kazekage. What do you think? Since being defeated by Ryujiro, Gaara has been able to communicate normally with Shikaku sealed within him. TCH, what's good about being Kazekage? Kid, don't forget how they treated you. In their eyes, you're nothing more than a tool. If it were up to me, I'd just slip out of the village and become a rogue ninja. After all, you have no emotional attachment to this place, right? Shikaku's disdainful voice echoed in Gaara's mind. Become a rogue ninja? Now Gaara, unlike before, wasn't influenced by Naruto's talk no jutsu and didn't have the desire to be accepted by everyone. On the contrary, he already felt a sense of boredom staying in the village. Being a rogue ninja didn't sound bad at all. After leaving Mount Myoboku, Ryujiro and Jiraiya didn't use reverse summoning jutsu to return. It took about a month for Jiraiya and Ryujiro to return to Konoha. When Ryujiro returned to the village, he heard a surprising piece of news. It was that Gaara, a Jinchuriki from the Hidden Sand Village, had been declared and shrank missing Nin after defecting from the village. In the original story, Gaara was supposed to become the fifth Kazekage. Now that Gaara had defected from the Hidden Sand Village, who would take the position of the fifth Kazekage? The only one who could possibly take the position now was Chiyo. The development of the plot exceeded his expectations. After returning to the Hyuga house, although it had only been a month since they last met, when Hinata heard that Ryujiro had returned, she rushed crazily and threw herself into Ryujiro's arms. Feeling the faint fragrance of Hinata, a faint smile appeared on Ryujiro's lips. Even in this world, he could still experience the feeling of home. He wondered if his Hogyoku could help Hinata evolve her Byakugan and awaken the Tensigan. The power of Hogyoku was immeasurable. After all, Ryujiro was now capable of creating terrifying creatures. He didn't mind stirring up some trouble in the shinobi world, becoming a mastermind behind the scenes in the storm that would engulf the entire shinobi world, opposing Uchiha Madara. Nagato's desire for peace was nothing but a futile illusion, imagining himself as a godlike existence. Moreover, those Rinnegan weren't originally Nagato's. If Nagato hadn't been a member of the Uzumaki clan, he would probably have died long ago after using the Rinnegan so frequently. Ryujiro, why do you feel a bit different? Hinata asked, staring at Ryujiro. Ryujiro gently stroked her hair and smiled faintly. I've changed a bit. Ryujiro's strength was several times or even dozens of times greater than before, so now he was at least confident in facing opponents like those at the level of six paths. But even so, he wanted to remain cautious whenever facing anyone because things like truth-seeking balls could obliterate everything. In terms of overall strength, he did surpass the previous Super Kage level shinobi, and even if Uchiha Madara were to be resurrected now, Ryujiro was confident in dealing with him. Of course, at this stage, the only one with strength surpassing that of the Kage was Nagato. Although Nagato possessed the Rinnegan and had the ability to absorb ninjutsu, Ryujiro's sword attacks didn't have a chakra nature. Even if his attack carried a portion of sage chakra, it could only absorb the sage chakra attached to the sword attack. After spending some time with Hinata at the Hyuga house, Ryujiro went to the Hokage's office. As an assistant to the Hokage, he couldn't afford to be idle. He couldn't just come back and not even meet the Hokage. At this time, Tsunade in the Hokage's office already knew about what Ryujiro had done at Mount Myoboku. In less than a day, he had mastered the sage mode, and it was a perfect sage mode. According to Jiraiya, even in his normal state, Ryujiro was in sage mode. It seemed that Ryujiro's physique had transformed into a sage's body like her grandfather's, able to automatically heal even if it's heavily injured. Tsunade couldn't understand how Ryujiro had done it. Seeing Ryujiro arrive at the Hokage's office, Tsunade frowned and glanced at him but didn't say much. I thought you'd spend the whole day with Hinata, she said. I didn't expect you to remember your Hokage. Ryujiro smiled faintly. What are you talking about, Hokage-sama? You're the Hokage. I'm your assistant. How could I forget you? All right, stop being a jerk. Tsunade didn't believe Ryujiro's words. This kid wasn't that nice. Now that you're back, half of these documents are for you to handle. Tsunade pointed to the large stack of documents on the desk. These days, she had been busy dealing with matters in the village, and being the Hokage wasn't as easy as Tsunade had thought. Although she had prepared for it beforehand, she hadn't expected it to be so difficult. Looking at the table full of documents, Ryujiro couldn't help but feel a chill. When would he finish dealing with so many documents? Despite his reluctance, he still agreed to Tsunade's request. After all, he wouldn't have to do it himself, and he could just hand it over to a shadow clone later. He agreed so quickly. Tsunade was somewhat surprised by Ryujiro's quick agreement. But as an assistant to the Hokage, Ryujiro should handle some things. If she were to handle all these documents by herself, who knows when she would finish. The power Tsunade had given Ryujiro was even greater than that of the previous assistants to the Hokage. Ryujiro could act on behalf of the Hokage. Although there were objections from the two elders and the higher-ups of Konoha, Tsunade managed to suppress them. As for the means she used, if Tsunade didn't sit in the Hokage's position, no one in the village would be able to take the position of Hokage, and by then, Konoha, which had just restored order, would become chaotic again. Ryujiro didn't just come to see Tsunade. He asked about Gaara's defection from the Hidden Sand Village. It had been a week since Gaara left the Hidden Sand Village. Although the Sand Village had sent some jonins to track him down, they were no match for Gaara. Though Gaara didn't kill them, being buried in sand up to their waists wasn't pleasant. If this had happened in the past, those who pursued Gaara would probably have already perished. A Jinchuriki defecting from a shinobi village, once this news spreads throughout the entire shinobi world, all shinobi villages will take action. If they could obtain a tailed beast, it would give any village the power to disrupt the balance of the shinobi world. Tailed beasts were known as weapons of mass destruction. After leaving the Hokage's office, Ryujiro hadn't gone far before a cold voice called out to him. At this time, Sasuke hadn't defected from the village. Perhaps it was because the right time hadn't come yet, or perhaps it was because he had been influenced by Ryujiro and the plot changed. Sasuke looked at Ryujiro with a complex expression. It had only been a short time since Ryujiro had become the assistant to the Hokage, and he was still just a chunin. This gap crushed the last bit of pride he had as a member of the Uchiha clan. His strength wasn't enough to kill Itachi. From Kakashi, he learned that not long ago, Itachi returned to the village, and Ryujiro fought against Itachi. And what shocked him was that Itachi's genjutsu not only didn't affect Ryujiro, but it seemed to backfire and injure him. Ryujiro's current strength completely surpassed Itachi. If he wanted to defeat Itachi, he would have to let go of his pride as an Uchiha and ask Ryujiro for help. For revenge, for killing Itachi, nothing else mattered to Sasuke. He finally understood that without strength, everything was meaningless. Only with strength like Ryujiro's could he control his own destiny. Sasuke, if you have come here to test the gap between us, then there's no need for that. With your intelligence, you should understand that the difference between us is like an abyss which is impossible to cross. Ryujiro spoke lightly. He had no interest whatsoever in Sasuke right now. It seemed Sasuke could only pique his interest after unlocking the Eternal Manjiku Sharingan. Sasuke gritted his teeth and clenched his fists. Even if Ryujiro didn't say it, he already knew the immense gap between him and Ryujiro. It was a gap that seemed endless, so much so that right now for Sasuke, there was no hope of catching up to Ryujiro. Ryujiro, please help me to become stronger. I want to have strength like yours. Please. Sasuke blurted out his inner thoughts in one breath, his breath becoming rapid, his heart pounding wildly. Ryujiro's expression shifted ever so slightly. What did he mean? Sasuke wanted him to help him become stronger. It seemed that the plot had truly been altered by him. What surprised him more was that Sasuke had actually set aside his pride as an Uchiha to ask him for help. Sasuke feared Ryujiro would refuse. If Ryujiro rejected him, Sasuke's remaining shreds of self-respect would be shattered. Why do you want to become stronger? Ryujiro asked lightly. Sasuke lifted his head, his eyes filled with hatred. To kill a man? Sure enough, Sasuke's current desire to become strong was to kill Itachi. Sasuke, you really don't understand Itachi's intentions. Ryujiro had no interest in being anyone's teacher, nor did he have any good ninjutsu to teach Sasuke. However, follow me, Ryujiro said lightly. Sasuke's face lit up, thinking Ryujiro had agreed to help him. He quickly caught up with Ryujiro's pace. They arrived at a relatively remote area from the village. There were no Umbu ninja in the vicinity, meaning no one was monitoring this area. Huff, huff, huff. Sasuke barely kept up with Ryujiro's speed, panting heavily when they arrived. I'm not interested in you, but there's someone here who might be suitable for you. Sasuke furrowed his brow. Someone suitable? Did that mean Ryujiro intended to introduce someone else to help him become stronger? There's no need to hide any longer, Orochimaru. Ryujiro's voice was indifferent. Hehe, as expected of you, Ryujiro. It seems you've anticipated my resurrection. Orochimaru, who had been previously killed by Ryujiro, reappeared before him, with Kabuto standing beside him. It seemed Kabuto had assisted in Orochimaru's resurrection. Even with Orochimaru's protection, Kabuto was still filled with fear towards Ryujiro. Such power was simply not of the same dimension. Initially, Ryujiro had no hesitation in killing Orochimaru. Moreover, Orochimaru mentioned that Ryujiro seemed to know everything about the ninja world. That was terrifying. Just like how Ryujiro knew Orochimaru would be resurrected. It's you. Sasuke's eyes shrank at the sight of Orochimaru, looking at him with some fear. Sasuke-kun, we meet again. It seems you've successfully integrated the power of the curse seal. Orochimaru admired Sasuke. Sasuke indeed didn't disappoint him. The curse seal of heaven had a death process, and it seemed Sasuke had successfully overcome it. This body. Orochimaru greedily licked his lips. Such an action made Sasuke feel a little scared. Did Ryujiro really sell him out? Was this guy the one he was talking about? But considering the curse mark Orochimaru placed on his own neck, which significantly boosted his strength, perhaps following this guy would indeed make him stronger. Orochimaru hadn't carefully sensed Ryujiro's aura before, but now as he scrutinized Ryujiro, his eyes couldn't help but shrink. This feeling. Senjutsu. Although Orochimaru couldn't use Sage Mode right now, he could still sense natural energy, and he had also seen Jiraiya using Sage Mode. While Ryujiro's current state was no different from usual, the feeling he gave off undeniably resembled Sage Mode. His Sage Mode was active even when he was in normal state. Orochimaru couldn't help but take in a sharp breath. Eternal. Ryujiro was able to maintain Eternal Sage Mode. Orochimaru's mind went blank. He had underestimated Ryujiro's potential and abilities. There was definitely something hidden within him that he couldn't reveal. Ryujiro, it's only been a short time since we last met, but you've become even more terrifying. Orochimaru looked at Ryujiro with fear. Ryujiro chuckled lightly. Orochimaru, it seems you've sensed it too. Kabuto and Sasuke were utterly baffled. The two of them had no idea what Orochimaru and Ryujiro were talking about. I won't waste any more time on nonsense. My disappearance from the village for so long will raise suspicions. I'll leave Sasuke to you. I'll come find you in a while. I hope you won't disappoint me. With that, Ryujiro's figure disappeared from the sight of Orochimaru and the others. Not with body flicker jutsu. Orochimaru was slightly surprised once again by Ryujiro's displayed capabilities. At this moment, Sasuke stood still. Was he just sold out by Ryujiro like that? Orochimaru looked at the now confused Sasuke and said slowly, "Sasuke-kun, I don't like to make things difficult for others. The choice is yours." Sasuke fell silent. If Orochimaru was in collusion with the village's rogue ninjas, it meant he had to defect from Konoha too. But if Orochimaru could make him stronger, then even if he had to defect from the village, he felt it was still worth it. In the end, Sasuke followed Orochimaru. Although Sasuke left on his own, with the power of Kyoka Suijetsu, the village's elders, even Tsunade, were hypnotized by Ryujiro. And one of the hypnotized ninja leaked information. He saw Sasuke with Orochimaru. This news shocked Tsunade. Wasn't Orochimaru killed by Ryujiro? How could he reappear again? Resurrection. Could such a thing really be done? In the end, the village's senior members issued a notice declaring Sasuke a rogue ninja of the Konoha village. Why? Why is Sasuke wanted as a rogue ninja? What's going on, Pervy Sage? Naruto grabbed Jiraiya's sleeve, incessantly asking. Jiraiya sighed. He went with Orochimaru. Orochimaru? Wasn't he killed by Ryujiro? Upon learning that Orochimaru had been resurrected, Naruto was even more shocked. Resurrected? How is that possible? Is there a jutsu that can bring someone back to life? Damn it. Why did Sasuke leave? Naruto clenched his fists in frustration. Even though the plot had been drastically altered because of Ryujiro, the bond between Naruto and Sasuke, two good friends, remained unchanged. Naruto wanted to know where Orochimaru was and wanted to bring Sasuke back. But even Jiraiya didn't know where Orochimaru was, let alone how Orochimaru was resurrected. Initially, he and Tsunade had personally witnessed Ryujiro killing Orochimaru. What Orochimaru had been researching in the years since leaving Konoha was a mystery. Orochimaru was no longer a human. But why did Jiraiya always feel like something was missing? When he was smashed away by Tsunade and saw Orochimaru killed by Ryujiro as he crawled out of the rubble. What happened during that time? Jiraiya and Tsunade had no idea. He hoped his worries were unfounded. Land of Rivers Gaara, draped in a brown cloak, arrived in the Land of Rivers. He finally experienced how liberating it felt to be free from constraints. In the eyes of the village elders, he, as a Jinchuriki, was nothing more than a weapon of war for the great nations. As for being Kazekage, he had no interest. Even powerful leaders like his father, the fourth Kazekage, ultimately died by someone else's hand. Freedom. It's truly wonderful. In a small town near the Land of Rivers, Gaara stopped at a dango shop. Smelling the fragrant aroma, Gaara couldn't help but lick his lips. After walking so far, he was too tired. It's better to rest here. After entering the shop, Gaara ordered two servings of dangos and sat down at his table. But as he glanced around the shop, his gaze suddenly stopped. That feeling. Gaara's eyes contracted, staring at the middle-aged man with extraordinary demeanor, carrying a huge black sword on his back, the blade adorned with exquisite patterns. Those eyes. Yes, those eyes were just like the guy from Konoha, those eyes. Both used swords, both possessed that sharp edge. Could this man be related to that guy from Konoha? Mihawk, who was drinking, seemed to sense Gaara's gaze, and their eyes met for a moment. Gaara's heart trembled, and he turned his head away. That feeling. He was sure. He had felt this from Ryujiro before, and this man was the second person to give him such a feeling. Shikaku, you saw that, right? Shikaku, residing within Gaara, could share his vision and naturally saw Mihawk. Yeah, I saw. That man is very powerful, not inferior to the brat from Konoha. Even Shikaku's tone became more serious. When did the shinobi world produce so many terrifying figures? If this man could produce slashes like Ryujiro, then he would be too terrifying. Did this man teach that brat from Konoha? Dingling, the wind chime at the door rang, and two men dressed in Akatsuki robes walked in. Gaara of the Sand, you've made it easy for us to find you. Daidara's face showed a sinister smile, while the shorter figure beside him, Sasori now inside his puppet Hiruko, emanated a gloomy gaze. The atmosphere in the dango shop seemed to instantly chill. Even the shopkeeper sensed that something was wrong and ran out in fear without even making dangos. Who are you people? Sand spilled out from Gaara's gourd behind him. Akatsuki. Gaara frowned. What's Akatsuki? Sasori, leave the Jinchuriki to me. I'll use my art to defeat the Jinchuriki. Sasori glanced deeply at Deidara. I don't like waiting. Don't worry, Sasori, it'll be over soon. Even the Akatsuki hadn't anticipated that a Jinchuriki would defect from the village. If he had been inside the village, it might have been tricky, but outside, they could deal with him without any worries. Now, it's time to show my art. Deidara's face revealed an artistic smile. At that moment, Mihawk, who was drinking, glanced at Deidara and Sasori's position. This was the Akatsuki that Ryujiro had mentioned? Mihawk had already witnessed jutsus in the shinobi world that were beyond his comprehension, using chakra to wield different attributes of ninjutsu, much like devil fruits in his world. The only difference was that chakra was a form of energy inherent to the human body. Gaara of the Sand. Hey, Deidara, looks like there are other powerful players here. Sasori felt a sense of dread from Mihawk. Other powerful players? That man? Indeed. He didn't seem ordinary, but this operation wasn't just him alone. With him and Sasori here, even Akage would fall. They had the confidence that they could make the Jinchuriki fall here. Their target was the one-tailed Jinchuriki. As long as that man didn't intervene, Sasori and Deidara wouldn't act against Mihawk. Unfortunately. Not long ago, Ryujiro had conveyed a message to Mihawk, instructing him to add Gaara into the Godai 13 as soon as he saw him. Akatsuki's goal was to capture the tailed beasts, and Mihawk couldn't just stand by. As Mihawk stood up, Sasori and Deidara instinctively narrowed their eyes. The aura emanating from this man was also too sharp. Just like a sword. Deidara, capturing the one-tailed Jinchuriki won't be easy. Sasori felt the pressure from Mihawk and said deeply. What do you want? Deidara asked Mihawk in a low voice. Akatsuki, this boy is joining our organization. So, leave him alone, otherwise the consequences won't be too good for you. Organization? Both Sasori and Deidara frowned. There were organizations other than the Akatsuki collecting tailed beast Jinchuriki? How was that possible? TCH. Deidara, I'll leave the Jinchuriki to you and I'll deal with this man. With that, the battle was about to begin. Boom boom. Sasori opened his mouth and shot out countless poison needles. These needles were all coated with deadly toxins. If even a little touched, death would follow shortly. Ding ding ding. Mihawk effortlessly deflected the poison needles with his black sword. This was just starting, and the real battle was about to begin. Although we couldn't reach 800 power stones, here is still an extra chapter. Mihawk's sharp eyes flashed a hint of coldness as he bent down, causing the ground to cave in abruptly as he exploded towards the location of Sasori. Yoru in his hand also shimmered with a strange cold light, under which it seemed like everything would be cut in two. TCH. Sasori sneered disdainfully. Sasori tail made of steel, accompanied by repeated flashes of cold light, stabbed towards Mihawk. Without any hesitation, a slash came down. Clang. Under Mihawk's blade, Sasori tail made of steel scattered into pieces everywhere. Sasori's face turned pale with shock. What was this black blade made of? It could easily cut through steel. This middle-aged man was even more terrifying than he had imagined. Could he be a samurai from the Land of Iron? But soon Sasori dispelled his absurd thoughts. The Land of Iron was just a small country, and its warriors were not particularly powerful. If there were truly such power, the Land of Iron would have long attracted the attention of the five great nations. Mihawk didn't give Sasori any chance to catch his breath, with his keen observation haki and years of battle experience. None of Sasori's attacks managed to harm him in the slightest. Zing, a crisp, sharp sword hum sounded. The surrounding airflow suddenly changed, and a terrifying slash rose from the ground, creating a mist and infinite dust. Boom! In an instant, the dazzling slash roared out like a tsunami, mercilessly tearing everything around. Sasori, hidden within his puppet, widened his eyes suddenly. The next moment, the Hiruko puppet exploded without warning, countless poison needles and sunban mercilessly ravaging everything around like a storm. Sasori! Deidara, who was fighting Gaara, exclaimed in horror. Sasori was defeated. Mihawk frowned as he realized things were not as simple as they seemed. Clang clang clang, accompanied by sparks, the flying sunban were cut into two and fell to the ground. Thousand arms manipulation. Thousands of arms surged like a flood, and in that instant, Mihawk's expression changed slightly. But even so, he didn't feel any pressure. He was just surprised by the appearance of thousands of arms in his line of sight. The jutsus in this world were indeed extremely strange. Swoosh swoosh swoosh. The dazzling shadows of swords danced, and thousands of arms were instantly cut into pieces by Mihawk, one by one. However, not long after, the severed arms began to gradually regenerate. It seems I shouldn't underestimate you. A voice with a hint of youthfulness entered Mihawk's ears. Mihawk's expression changed dramatically as he looked at the young man in front of him. This feeling. So, this young man is the real body. That means the one just now was a puppet. Truly miraculous, that a young man could hide within such a small puppet. Ha! Boom, Deidara's clay bomb exploded instantly. Sasori? Eh? Sasori transformed? Why, what's going on? Hey! Sasori! Sasori below listened to Deidara's idiotic voice and showed an impatient expression. This kid was too annoying. Although Sasori had a youthful face, he was much older than Deidara. Otherwise, he wouldn't have taken care of Deidara so much along the way. Let's start the second round. Sasori's eyes flickered with a cold gleam as he summoned another puppet using his puppet jutsu. A human puppet made from the body of the third Kazekage. Meanwhile, upon receiving the message shared by Mihawk, Ryujiro had already left Konoha. As for the documents given to him by Tsunade, he had handed them over to his shadow clone to deal with. Gaara, a Jinchuriki, if he could obtain some chakra from one tail, he wondered if Hogyoku could absorb it. If that were possible, what changes would occur if he collected the chakra of all the tailed beasts? Would it produce a yin-yang release? Or, would he enter the six paths mode like the ten tails Jinchuriki? These were all just Ryujiro's speculations, and whether they could actually be achieved was unknown. Boom boom boom, while on the way, Ryujiro suddenly heard a commotion ahead. A green-colored slash exploded, creating a huge wave and hurricane that swept through the entire forest. It was Mihawk Slash. In the next moment, Ryujiro's figure disappeared instantly. At this moment, Sasori's expression was not very good. The human puppet made by the third Kazekage was already covered in scars, and nearby, puppets destroyed by Mihawk Slashes were everywhere. He had never seen someone with such terrifying swordsmanship. When did such a person emerge in the ninja world again? A flying slash, like this, was too scary. The Konoha village's sword genius was said to be able to produce flying slashes. Could there be any connection between him and the person in front of him? Sasori knew that his strength was not comparable to Mihawk's. The man standing before him could easily cut through them. He and Deidara had never expected to encounter such an unexpected situation while trying to capture a Jinchuriki. Just then, explosions rang out like thunder, and the terrifying shockwave dispersed the clouds in the sky. Gaara's strength at this time was simply no match for Deidara. In the original anime, back when he became Kazekage, Gaara was still defeated by Deidara alone, let alone the Gaara of this period who hadn't undertaken any missions and was much less experienced compared to Deidara of that period. The sand armor on Gaara's body gradually fell off, and his bloodshot eyes stared at Deidara. Is this the end? Shikaku, lend me your power? The sharp voice of Shikaku echoed in Gaara's mind. TSK. Boy, do you think I will lend you my strength just because you asked? What do you take me for? Don't forget that I am a tailed beast, and I am not friends with you humans. But I might lend you my strength, just give me your body. Shikaku had been patient for a long time and couldn't wait to roam the outside world again. Handing his body over to Shikaku would also mean his consciousness being swallowed up. He and the tailed beast were not friends, he couldn't let himself be controlled by a tailed beast. Ah, his consciousness was dissipating. Is this where it ends for me? When Deidara was about to take Gaara away to assist Sasori, suddenly a figure rushed out. Deidara's expression changed dramatically as he controlled his flying device, and cold sweat dripped from his forehead when he saw the familiar face. It's you. Deidara was extremely fearful of Ryujiro. The genjutsu he had quietly cast had played them in the palm of his hand, including several members of the Akatsuki. Ryujiro looked calmly at Deidara from above, dragging Gaara, who had fallen from the sky. Sprinkled on the bones of the beast. Sharp tower, red crystal, steel ring. Move and become the wind, stop and become calm. The sound of warring spears fills the empty castle. Hado number 63. Raikoho. A massive spiritual pressure gathered in Ryujiro's palm, and a dazzling flash of lightning suddenly burst forth. The thunder serpent danced, transforming into a brilliant thunder pillar crashing down towards Deidara in the sky. The dazzling brilliance of the thunder was stunning, the terrifying energy contained within it emitting a sizzling sound as it frictioned with the air. Deidara watched as the thunder, resembling a thunder dragon, swept towards him, wanting to dodge, but it was already too late. Unlike ninjutsu, the speed of this thunder attack reached that of natural lightning. Even if Deidara wanted to evade, it was already too late. The raging thunder shredded the claymade birds. Before the thunder, those white birds seemed as fragile as paper. With an unstable center of gravity, Deidara fell from the sky to the ground, while on the other side, Mihawk also ended his battle. The merciless black blade plunged into Sasori's heart, amidst the scattered puppet parts. The puppet made from the third Kazekage was powerless against Mihawk's black blade. Sasori stared wide-eyed, unbelievably, at Mihawk. He actually lost? That terrifying swordsmanship. Not ninjutsu, but sheer brute force incomprehensible to him. Is this my end? Sasori's gaze gradually lost its color, as his eyes completely lost their color, his heart also stopped beating. Deidara, falling from the sky, had a trace of blood at the corner of his mouth, feeling extremely uncomfortable throughout his internal organs. Deidara, in a sorry state, saw Sasori lying on the ground and the scattered puppet parts, his eyes suddenly contracted. Sasori. Damn it. Damn it. You actually killed Sasori. Deidara's face twisted with endless rage, all visible on his face. None of you will escape this place. Let's all die together. Deidara tore off a piece of his clothing, revealing a grim mouth on his left chest. Ryujiro's eyes couldn't help but shrink. It's that move. Art is an explosion. Deidara mixed the last bit of clay on him. Under his will, chakra had already been mobilized. Even if you want to escape, it's too late. Under Deidara's crazy smile, he seemed to have already prepared himself for his own death. But after the words fell, nothing happened around him. The expression on Deidara's face gradually stiffened. What's going on? Why? Clearly, chakra has been mobilized. Why hasn't the jutsu been activated? Could it be? Failed? Pfft. A grim blade plunged into Deidara's heart. Ryujiro looked indifferently at the unbelieving Deidara and slowly said. Jinjutsu, my jinjutsu can completely control the opponent's senses, you didn't do anything just now. Deidara looked at Ryujiro incredulously, unwilling to accept it. To be able to dominate the five senses with jinjutsu. How terrifying. He never thought that his ending would be so mundane. With a thud, Deidara fell heavily to the ground. The art duo, Deidara and Sasori, both died here. And almost all of them were crushed without any room for resistance. With these two dead, the Akatsuki would probably be in a frenzy situation. A sinister smile couldn't help but appear at the corner of Ryujiro's mouth. Things should develop in an interesting direction. Something should be left behind to let the Akatsuki know about the existence of the Godai 13. At this moment, Gaara had already lost consciousness. Looking at the devastated land around him, Ryujiro felt nothing in his heart. Although this is within the borders of the Land of Rivers, the Land of Rivers is just a small country. Even with just Mihawk alone, it's enough to wipe out a small country like the Land of Rivers. In this world, small countries have no rights, they can only be exploited. Once war breaks out, the small countries of the ninja world are just chess pieces in the war, and no one will care about the survival or death of a small country. Even if a small country disappears, a new country will emerge. Mihawk and Ryujiro looked at each other, then disappeared into the dense forest. In a huge tree, Nagato's pale face, already as thin as a skull, couldn't help but twitch. Deidara and Sasori are dead. Beside him, the exquisite beauty Konan wore a face of disbelief. Deidara and Sasori. Weren't they supposed to capture one-tailed Jinchuriki? Although it's a Jinchuriki, the current Jinchuriki hasn't fully mastered his power. Moreover, this time, it's Sasori and Deidara who were dispatched together. Even capturing a Jinchuriki should have been easy for the two of them combined. What happened to them? Nagato, should we? Konan paused for a moment. Nagato interrupted her words, "Don't notify the others for now. I'll control Pain to go and take a look." Soon, using Pain made from Yahiko's body, Nagato arrived and saw the two bodies of Deidara and Sasori. Looking at the traces of the battle, the hidden Nagato's face suddenly became extremely ugly. Deidara and Sasori were dead. The entire forest was devastated, with broken trees and scattered yellow sand everywhere. What made Nagato most uneasy was the hundreds of meters long, straight, smooth cut, as if this vast land was cut by some sharp weapon. Deidara and Sasori were completely overwhelmed by brute force. There are such terrifying people in the ninja world. On Deidara's body, Pain noticed a white piece of paper, and when he saw the character's Godai 13 on it, his eyes suddenly contracted. Pain murmured with great solemnity, "Godai 13, I've never heard about them. Could it be that besides us, Akatsuki, there are other organizations in this world, trying to capture the tailed beasts? And there's no sign of a Jinchuriki here either. It will be trouble, if that organization is after the tailed beasts just like us, our future plans will be difficult to execute. But, if they encounter someone from the Godai 13, Nagato will show no mercy. Only those who feel pain and no pain can understand the preciousness of peace, and no one can stop him from the path to peace. If someone comes in his way, he will crush them. Because, he is a god." In the dark and murky void, Gaara gradually regained his consciousness. He looked around hazily at the eerie lights, but his eyes dilated instantly when he saw the two figures, and his foggy mind cleared in an instant. "Ryujiro." There was a hint of fear in Gaara's eyes as he stared solemnly at Ryujiro, who was different from before. "Boy, even if I wanted to help you this time, it would be futile. This kid is too terrifying." The voice of Shikaku echoed faintly in Gaara's mind. Gaara's eyes contracted suddenly. "What do you mean by this, Shikaku? Even a tailed beast was scared of Ryujiro? The chakra flowing in this brat's body is sage chakra. Even in normal state, he can maintain sage mode. His strength is at least several times greater than before, and that overflowing sage chakra? To be honest, I'm not confident in dealing with him." Gaara couldn't help but draw in a sharp breath. "Unbelievable. Gaara of the San? Join my organization," Ryujiro said casually. "What?" Gaara was stunned, looking at Ryujiro in confusion. "Join the organization? Isn't Ryujiro a ninja of Konoha? What does his organization mean? Does Ryujiro have another identity besides being a ninja of Konoha? What do you mean? What organization are you referring to?" Ryujiro patiently explained to Gaara. "A genius like Gaara, once he becomes a perfect Jinchuriki, his strength will definitely be stronger than most Kages." It didn't take long for Gaara to be shocked, his mouth hanging open. "Godai 13? An organization that will influence the ninja world in the future? This Godai 13 was created by Ryujiro, why would he create such an organization? If he disagrees, will Ryujiro kill him right here? Joining the organization doesn't seem like a bad idea. He has already rebelled against Sunagakure, and it's better to do something interesting than to wander around aimlessly. Moreover, Gaara has already recognized his own strength. Perhaps he is outstanding within the village, but outside the village, there are still many ruthless people hidden in the ninja world. Compared to those people, he was too weak." "I agree," Gaara looked at Ryujiro and said. A smile appeared at the corner of Ryujiro's mouth. "A wise choice. This is the uniform of our organization. Take off the forehead protector of Sunagakure, you have already left the village, so the forehead protector is meaningless." Gaara took off his forehead protector and put on clothes similar to Mihawk's. The uniforms made by Ryujiro were similar to those of the 13 court guard squads in Bleach. "What is the purpose of our organization?" Gaara, now wearing the uniform, asked in confusion. "For now it is to secretly control the smaller villages," Ryujiro said slowly. "Although the influence of small villages is minimal, if they control all small villages, everything will be different. Moreover, there is an organization like Akatsuki on the surface helping them, Godai 13, to resist any threats. Control small villages. Next. Shikaku, let's talk. Ryujiro said casually to Gaara. The next moment, Shikaku, who was locked in the prison within the vast space, became furious upon seeing Ryujiro. Boy, how dare you appear in front of me? Shikaku's roar shook the entire ceiling space. TCH, although you are both tailed beasts, the gap between you and the Ninetales is very huge. Huh? You damn kid. What did you say? Having his pride hurt by Ryujiro, Shikaku, like a cat whose tail has been stepped on, glared angrily at Ryujiro. Facing Shikaku's anger, Ryujiro remained indifferent and continued. Enough, let's get back to the point. I need some of your chakra. You want my chakra? Shikaku was first surprised, then sneered. Boy, you want my chakra, right? Then, if you want it, you should beg me. If I'm in a good mood, I might give you some. Shikaku didn't even know he was asking for trouble. Ryujiro's gaze gradually became somber. Boom! A huge and cold spiritual pressure suddenly erupted from Ryujiro's body, causing the entire ceiling space to tremble. Feeling the terrifying spiritual pressure, Shikaku couldn't help but tremble. This feeling, it wasn't only the power of a shinobi. This is not a negotiation. If you want to experience my new power, I don't mind using you as a test subject. Ryujiro's voice was extremely cold, and he looked like a soul-reaping grim reaper. This feeling. What's going on? Tailed beasts themselves are aggregates of chakra without souls, but for some reason, under the influence of sage chakra and spiritual pressure, Shikaku actually felt what death was like. You should know that tailed beasts are formed from the chakra of the ten tails. Even if they appear to die on the surface, they can still resurrect years later. Because tailed beasts themselves are life forms, formed from the huge chakra. Gulp. As a beast, Shikaku couldn't help but shrink his eyes, he had to succumb under this huge pressure. TCH. Damn brat. Shikaku could act tough. After Ryujiro's spirit withdrew from the ceiling space. A dark red-tailed beast chakra overflowed from Gaara's right hand. Such a high density of tailed beast chakra, besides being a Jinchuriki, would instantly damage anyone else who touched it. Ryujiro, are you sure about this? Gaara asked worriedly. As a Jinchuriki, he knew very well that tailed beast chakra was not ordinary chakra, and it could affect one's mind. If it were another ninja, perhaps they would indeed be affected by tailed beast chakra. But Ryujiro was different. He possessed both sage chakra and spiritual power, two huge energies. The tailed beast chakra would have no effect on him at all. At the moment when his fingertips touched the tailed beast chakra, the evil tailed beast chakra tried to control Ryujiro's body. Just at that moment of agitation, the tailed beast chakra was suppressed by an inexplicable force. The Hogyoku inside Ryujiro's body also reacted. Under the suppression of spiritual energy and sage chakra, the tailed beast chakra gradually absorbed into the Hogyoku. The three different energies circulated and merged within Ryujiro's body, and he felt another type of chakra attribute in his body. This was tailed beast chakra, it's nothing new. However, it seems that after the tailed beast chakra was absorbed by the Hogyoku itself also changed. This feeling was a transformation of life energy, and Ryujiro had gradually evolved unconsciously. Swoosh! The rioting tailed beast chakra enveloped Ryujiro's body. The dark red tailed beast chakra wrapped around Ryujiro's body, and at this moment, Ryujiro looked more like a humanoid beast standing upright. Tailed beast transformation. With a portion of the one-tailed chakra, Ryujiro could enter the tailed beast transformation state. However, the tailed beast mode did not bring much improvement in strength to Ryujiro. On the contrary, those negligible improvements weren't much of help to Ryujiro. Hey hey hey! Are you kidding me? This kid can enter tailed beast mode with just a portion of my chakra? It was as if he was his Jinchuriki. What on earth is going on? Even Gaara had a face full of shock. Just with a small portion of chakra, Ryujiro could enter a state of tailed beast transformation, just like a Jinchuriki. Absorbing the chakra of one tail not only granted Ryujiro the ability of tailed beast mode, but he also seemed to gain the attribute of wind chakra. It seemed that Hogyoko thought the chakra of the tailed beasts was worth absorbing. What would happen if he absorbed the chakra of all nine tailed beasts? Would he get in young release? Or perhaps? Hehe. Things were getting interesting. Ryujiro paid no attention to Gaara's shocked expression as he said, "Your current strength is still too weak. You should go and train under that man for a while." That man? Hidden Sound Village, a certain underground cave. Orochimaru, who was researching Kekkei Genkai in the base, suddenly furrowed his brow. His figure disappeared into the laboratory. Outside the cave, Ryujiro, Gaara, and Mihawk arrived at the entrance. After a while, Orochimaru appeared before them. When Gaara saw Orochimaru, he felt a strange familiarity, but he couldn't assure himself that he had never seen the sickly-looking man before. Ryujiro, so you know about this place after all? No need for small talk, Orochimaru. I'm sending someone to you. I'm entrusting Gaara to you. Oh? Gaara of Sand. Orochimaru's eyes lit up. He looked at Gaara as if he were a valuable treasure. Feeling Orochimaru's gaze, Gaara's whole body broke out in goosebumps. Why did he feel like he was being tricked? Was Ryujiro really going to make him follow this man? This man seemed quite perverted. Mihawk looked at Orochimaru, sensing his chilling aura, which he disliked greatly. A Jinchuriki. But it was quite valuable for research. Of course, if Ryujiro asked him to train Gaara, Orochimaru probably wouldn't dare to act recklessly. However, Ryujiro seemed to have undergone another change in his aura. It felt as if he was evolving, similar to the white snake sage in the Ryuchi cave. Was Ryujiro evolving? Orochimaru's fervent thought stirred his previously dormant heart once again. The white snake sage had lived for thousands of years. The reason Orochimaru was expelled from Konoha was because he conducted human experiments, seeking to pave a path to eternal life. Having experienced wars, Orochimaru felt that life was too fragile. The lifespan of a human was nothing more than a fleeting moment. Only eternity was the sole truth in the world. Although Orochimaru theoretically developed a method for eternal life, the flaw of living corpse reincarnation was also quite fatal. It not only depended on the compatibility of the body but also required finding another body for reincarnation after several years. The so-called eternal life of living corpse reincarnation was maintained through repeated reincarnations. Although Orochimaru considered this a form of eternity, he was not satisfied. If Ryujiro was evolving towards the same level as the White Snake Sage, would he also gain eternal life like the White Snake Sage? Could he also? If Ryujiro could help him attain immortality, Orochimaru would do whatever Ryujiro asked of him. To Orochimaru's fervent gaze, Ryujiro also felt puzzled. Did Orochimaru still want to use his own body for reincarnation? However, come to think of it, the three great sacred places likely had different sage modes. If one learned all of them, would there be unexpected changes? Ryujiro was greedy. On the path to becoming stronger, he couldn't afford to consider so much. Moreover, with Hogyoku present, if the sage modes were mutually exclusive, he probably wouldn't be affected. With Hogyoku there, he shouldn't be affected by anything. Entering Orochimaru's cave, it felt like entering a dark prison. Indeed, this kind of place suited Orochimaru's snake-like preference for dark, damp caves. There was no sign of Sasuke in the base. In order to become stronger, Orochimaru had already arranged training opponents for Sasuke. Currently, Sasuke was not far away, battling against Kimimaro. At this time, Sasuke was not a match for Kimimaro. The Shikatsu Miyaku Kekkei Genkai was one of the more unique Kekkei Genkai in the shinobi world, but it also posed a threat to Kimimaro. Kimimaro's condition was gradually deteriorating, and the cause of this illness was likely the side effects of the Kaguya clan's unique Kekkei Genkai. Kabuto had been studying Kimimaro's Kekkei Genkai, but in the end, it was of no avail. In the original anime, after the fierce battle with Gaara, Kimimaro ultimately perished in the fight. One of the reasons Ryujiro had Gaara accompany Orochimaru was that the Sound Village was a good refuge for Gaara. Now, not only was the Sand Village searching for him, but also several other major shinobi villages. The temptation of capturing a Jinchuriki. How could the other major villages control themselves? The Sand Village was already at its wit's end. Even if Chiyo didn't want to get involved in the affairs of the Land of Wind and the Sand Village, she had no choice. If anything unexpected happened again in the Sand Village, one of the five great shinobi villages, they would probably be in jeopardy. No matter which village, a Jinchuriki presence could ultimately affect the balance of the shinobi world. Even Konoha probably didn't expect Gaara to be with Orochimaru. After arranging everything for Gaara, Orochimaru looked at Mihawk beside him and couldn't help but ask. Ryujiro, why don't you introduce me to the person next to you? What's his name? Mihawk. Before Ryujiro could explain, Mihawk coldly uttered those words himself. Ahem. Orochimaru couldn't help but cough a few times. What a strange person. Those eyes were just like Ryujiro's. But now, Ryujiro's sharpness had diminished considerably, yet he gave off an even more terrifying vibe. It was as if facing an abyss. Alright, Orochimaru, besides entrusting Gaara to you, there's one more thing I want to discuss with you. Ryujiro, feel free to speak. A smile appeared on Orochimaru's face. Join my organization. Organization. Orochimaru's eyes constricted, looking at Ryujiro with some doubt. The organization I've created, Godai 13, will eventually dominate the entire shinobi world. Ryujiro said this calmly, but it was his unique charisma that made it convincing. I'll join. Orochimaru didn't hesitate at all. He was eager for his relationship with Ryujiro to be eased, and in his eyes, all hopes of obtaining true immortality lay with Ryujiro. Ryujiro wasn't surprised. In his view, having a mad scientist like Orochimaru join wasn't bad. Orochimaru was a genius himself, and for Ryujiro, Orochimaru had value to be exploited.
And that concludes this episode. If you enjoyed it, I'd seriously love it if you guys could leave a like on the video, as it genuinely helps out so much, and it keeps me going, plus it takes only 1 second. That said, have a wonderful day. See you in the next one.